It's Gordon Brown's biggest by-election test, a battle for votes in the Prime Minister's homeland, a Scottish National Party challenge to Labour's grip on its West of Scotland heartland. Hello and welcome to live coverage of the Glasgow East by-election, a contest which will not only decide who's to be the next MP for the area, but could also have a big bearing on Gordon Brown's leadership of the Labour Party. Well, it's all over, bar the counting, which is well underway now at the Tollcross Leisure Centre in Glasgow's East End. We'll bring you the latest from there shortly, and of course we'll be there live for the result itself, which is expected any time after 12:30. Well, to help make sense of developments, our commentary team tonight includes politics professor John Curtice, the political journalist Angus McLeod, and our political panel chaired by Jon Sopel.
Yes, good evening and welcome to the heart of the BBC's Broadcasting Centre here in Glasgow, where we're joined with a stellar lineup of politicians and analysts to guide us through the evening. Now, by-elections used to be so easy. You wanted to give the government a kicking and so you voted against the ruling party. But devolution has made that so much more complicated because now there are two governments, the one in London and the one here in Scotland. It's a by-election which is about peculiarly Scottish issues, but it could have a major impact on the Brown administration at Westminster. Indeed, some are speculating that it could presage the end of Gordon Brown altogether if Labour lose. Well, among others, I'll be chewing over these issues with Douglas Alexander, the International Development Secretary and close confidant of Gordon Brown, and with Nicola Sturgeon, the Deputy First Minister of the government here at Holyrood.
Now, the polls have been closed for the last hour or so, and as we've been seeing, the counting is proceeding apace. Well, our reporter Aileen Clarke is at the count. Aileen.
Well, the ballot boxes are still coming in, and as you say, Glenn, the counting is going on, and it's very tense here in Tollcross, and that is an understatement. If I tell you that the most optimistic prediction I've heard from the Labour camp this evening is it's going to be close, and the most pessimistic is think we've lost it, then you might begin to get just a wee bit of the flavour of what's going on in this hall. Now, interestingly, we're hearing the turnout seems to be round about the 46% mark. That's the kind of best guesstimate so far, which of course is perhaps a bit higher than was being predicted. But what'll be interesting tonight is somebody from the Labour camp said to me, when they were out chapping on the doors, they did get some of their voters saying, you know what, I usually vote Labour, I'm not voting for you this time. Now, did that mean that they weren't voting at all? Or does that 46% turnout mean they did come out and vote, but their vote's gone somewhere else? Interestingly, when you speak to the SNP camp, they have lots of stories of people coming up to them in the street tonight and saying, do you know something? I don't usually vote for the SNP, but I've given you my vote this time. Don't let me down. So, that's a flavour of what's going on here tonight. Very tense atmosphere. If you take a look there, you'll see a lot of people round those tables waiting and watching for what this vote's going to be. We could know as early as 12:30, might be a wee bit later.
Let's hope we don't have to wait too long. Thanks very much for the moment, Aileen. Right now, let's talk with John Curtice, Professor of Politics at Strathclyde University, and Angus McLeod, the Scottish political editor of the Times newspaper. John Curtice, the SNP leader, Scottish First Minister Alex Salmond, predicting a political earthquake in Glasgow East. Is that what this is shaping up to be?
Well, if Aileen Clarke is right, and if indeed it now looks as though the balance of probability is that perhaps the SNP might just have pulled it off, and we have to say that's still an if, it's still far from certain, but if that is the case, then certainly it's going to be a result that's going to send political tremors around the UK, and they will reach all the way to 10 Downing Street. This was meant to be the one by-election the Labour Party couldn't conceivably lose, even in the context of what is now the most unpopular government, Labour government, in polling history. This was going to demonstrate there was a limit. If they cannot hang on to this by-election, where the swing required of 22% has only ever been exceeded by the SNP in three previous by-elections, including the two famous government by-elections, then that will further underline the serious electoral trouble that the government is in. And that electoral trouble, of course, for many people, is blamed on Gordon Brown.
And Angus McLeod, will Gordon Brown's nails be bitten down beyond the quick?
Oh, I think he'd be very, very nervous as we speak tonight. But I think that Brown goes on holiday this weekend. I think this is another big black cloud over him as he goes on holiday. I think then to go on to say that the tremors, that if Aileen is right, that the tremors have reached Downing Street will shake Brown out of number 10 is, I think, going a bit far at this stage. I think really that, you know, in terms of removal of a prime minister, you really are talking about members of the cabinet turning on Gordon Brown and saying it's time to go. Now, I don't really see much sign of that. I don't think David Miliband, James Parnell or Alan Johnson or any of these people are about to wield the dagger. But I think that what it means is that it puts more pressure on Brown, A, to get through the party conference in the autumn, and much more importantly, and I think the real crunch time is going to come for Brown when the next tranche of English local government elections are held next year. If that is bad, that's only a year to go before a general election. Something then has got to give. I don't think it'll give just because of tonight.
What do you think, John? Can one by-election decide the future of a prime minister?
Well, not necessarily. Let's perhaps remember the Eastbourne by-election back in 1990, when nobody expected the Liberal Democrats to win that seat. That set off the chain of events, that defeat of the Conservatives, unexpected defeat, the chain of events that eventually led to the downfall of Margaret Thatcher. Now, I think what we had to realise, we're in the unpredictable world of trying to predict when a party, including its senior members, might panic. What it requires, in a sense, it's quite clear that there are considerable mutterings about Gordon Brown's leadership. And each of the election reverses have been, starting with English local elections, followed by Crewe and Nantwich, and then in Henley, there have been mutterings about whether or not Gordon Brown should stay. It's clear, at least, that the possibility that, as that what Angus is referring to, that senior cabinet ministers might need to go to Gordon Brown and say to him, we think you ought to go, that at least has crossed some people's minds. Now, the question is, how much further does that this by-election result push it? And does this by-election result cause the Labour Party to panic? It's always impossible to predict when people might panic, but clearly, if there were to be a serious by-election result tonight, the possibility of panic cannot be ruled out.
OK, John Curtice and Angus McLeod, thanks for the moment. We'll be back with you a little bit later. Right now, though, let's cross to my colleague Jon Sopel and his political panel. John.
Glenn, thank you very much. Yes, we'll be joined throughout the evening, what might be a long evening, by Nicola Sturgeon, the Deputy First Minister of Scotland, and by Douglas Alexander, the International Development Secretary. I don't know what the 21st century equivalent is of jungle drums, maybe blackberries and text messages, but what are you hearing?
I think it's too close to call, John. I think that's the reality. Turnout, as we've heard, is a bit higher, perhaps, than many people expected. But what I think is clear is that there has been a significant shift towards the SNP as people have decided to send Gordon Brown and Labour a very strong message, and also place a vote of confidence in the SNP government in Holyrood. But as to the result, we'll know soon enough, but I think it's on a knife edge.
OK, well, let's try and set the benchmark, if you like. You have to win, don't you, for it to be a good night for the SNP?
Oh, for goodness sake, this is Labour's third safest seat in Scotland. It's one of their safest seats in the whole of the UK. Now, we don't know the result yet. I think it is too close to call, but I think it will be absolutely beyond doubt that there will have been a significant movement towards the SNP. And I think that says that there is a real lack of confidence in Labour in London and growing and strong confidence in the SNP government in Holyrood.
Douglas Alexander, what is a good result for you tonight?
Well, obviously, we want to win this by-election. Any party wants to win any by-election that they contest. But I think it's been a tough fight. It will continue in modern politics to be a tough fight in any seat. I came in a by-election just 6 months after May the 1st, 1997. That was a tough fight even then. So we've just got a little longer to wait to find the result.
We're looking at these pictures now from the count, just a few miles away from where we're speaking at the moment. I mean, are you hearing anything, Douglas Alexander, about... I mean, do you agree with that? At least let's get some agreement. Do you agree with Nicola Sturgeon that it's on a knife edge?
Well, it's certainly been close in the course of the day. I actually saw Nicola out working for the SNP when I was out working for Labour today. There were teams of activists from both parties out knocking on doors, trying to persuade people to come out and vote. I think one interesting feature is we've seen quite a significant uplift in turnout in the early evening, in the sense that the level of polling was quite low during the day, but then obviously people came home from their work, had their tea and went out to vote. And in that sense, the turnout is slightly higher than I would have anticipated even 3, 4, 5 hours ago.
Yes, but a defeat would be a disaster, wouldn't it? It would be a political earthquake.
Well, obviously, we don't want to lose any Labour seat. That's hardly a revelation. And that's why we've been working hard to try and win this seat. But as to predicting the result, we'll just have to wait and see.
Yeah, but a majority of one, is that good enough? I'm just interested.
I'm in a rare position of having fought two by-elections. I fought a by-election in Perth and then a by-election in Paisley. I've learned that there's no prizes in politics for second place. So in that sense, if you win, then you deserve the congratulations of your opponents. And politics moves on. So, of course, if we were to win tonight, I would be delighted. If we lose, I'll be disappointed.
And you know the obvious questions that are going to flow from this about the position of the Prime Minister?
Well, I think as a Labour Party, we fight these campaigns together. That's why we've had almost 400 activists on the streets today. Our victories are sweetened and our defeats are softened by the fact that we take them together as a team.
Together as a team, so no one individual to blame. It's just the whole performance
with respect,
of the government.
You're asking me to accept the blame for a defeat that we haven't actually had a result for yet. Let's wait and see the result.
OK, let's wait and see the result. Just coming back to you, Nicola, I mean, you know, you say it would be astonishing to pull off a victory. I mean, in 1999, I look at the Hamilton South by-election, there was a 22.5% swing to the SNP. 1999, Labour were riding high in the polls. I mean, Labour have never been so low as they are today. Therefore, I'm saying, QED, it should be easy for you to do pretty well here.
Well, yeah, it's been a hard-fought by-election. There's absolutely no doubt about that. You know, we have to wait and see what the result is. I think possibly one of the few things Douglas and I might agree on during the course of the evening is at this stage of the election, predictions are perhaps not easy for politicians to make. But one thing I think is beyond doubt, and that is that there has been a significant shift in favour of the SNP. And I think it speaks volumes in the campaign that while Alex Salmond was leading from the front, a clear asset to the SNP campaign, Gordon Brown not only wasn't visible in the campaign, he never visited Glasgow East, but he was the name
Prime ministers don't do by-election
campaigns. Tony Blair actually did visit by-elections until he stopped being an asset for the Labour Party and became a liability. That's when he stopped visiting by-elections. But it's not just that Gordon Brown didn't visit. He was the name that didn't cross the lips of either the Labour candidate or Labour activists going round the doors. So, you know, clearly, whatever Douglas says, and I understand why he says it, Gordon Brown is a significant liability for the Labour Party.
Gordon Brown wasn't very much seen either in leaflets or anything, really, was he?
Yeah, of course he was on leaflets. And if you look at the issues that dominated the campaign with respect to issues about rising fuel prices, rising food prices, the difficulties in terms of people's mortgages, those are issues which directly Gordon's been speaking to in the last few weeks. That's why he travelled to Jeddah. That's why he's been trying to recognise and deal with the fact that really for the first time in many decades we're seeing the importing of inflation, but a real pinch being felt by people. And in that sense, he's been getting on with the job, which is actually what I think most people, not just in Glasgow East, but across the country, would be wanting him to do.
OK, there'll be an awful lot more throughout the course of the evening where we will kick some of these issues around a little further. The count is well underway, but it's going to be a little way off before we get a result. Now, until today, Glasgow East was the third safest Labour seat in Scotland. It might still be. The party took over 60% of the vote here at the general election 3 years ago. But this by-election comes after disastrous results for Labour at Crewe and Nantwich and Henley. So all of the main parties felt it was worth giving it a really good try in Glasgow East this time round. And with a disastrous start to Labour's campaign, the SNPs were rubbing their hands, talking of a political earthquake, as Katrina Renton now reports.
Welcome to Glasgow East, a place not used to this much attention. Over the last 4 weeks, it's been invaded. There's not a street they've not pounded, barely a door they've not knocked, as they all try to hunt down unsuspecting voters in a seat that was, until now at least, one of Labour's safest in Scotland.
David Marshall, Scottish Labour Party candidate, 18,700...
Happier times. But on Friday the 28th of June, after 29 years, the local MP, David Marshall, decided to tell his constituency Labour Party he was resigning because of ill health. And just as this news was starting to seep out...
It is with deep regret that I have tendered my resignation following the decisions of the Standards Committee this week.
The party's leader in Scotland, Wendy Alexander, resigned. It was one of Scottish Labour's worst weekends, and you couldn't make up what happened next.
Here in Tollcross Leisure Centre, the votes are being counted in the sports hall through there. But it was in this very room that Labour's campaign got off to a disastrous start. The election had been formally called on the Tuesday. Labour were planning to launch their campaign on the Saturday and were going to select their candidate here on the Friday. The problem? The favourite local councillor, George Ryan, failed to turn up, leaving Labour without a candidate, and the other parties calling this Labour's lost weekend.
With their candidates ready to go, the others lost no time.
The Labour Party have no candidate, no leader, a Prime Minister who's no show.
The Liberal Democrats were on their marks and ready to go. And even the Conservatives had decided Glasgow East wasn't a lost cause as they launched their campaign at St Jude's Church in Easterhouse.
Thank you very much, Ian. And I'm pleased to be here with Davina and with Ian Duncan-Smith to launch our campaign for the by-election in Glasgow East.
6 days on since the election was called, Labour still didn't have anyone. Finally, they selected Margaret Curran, who already has a job as the member of the Scottish Parliament for Glasgow Bayliston.
I am honoured to be nominated to fight this seat for the Labour Party in the east end of Glasgow.
Now they could all get on with it, and they did, relatively gaff-free, even if, because of the holidays, there were often more politicals than punters, but at least they had each other and the media to talk to.
The areas that make up Glasgow East have been represented by Labour for almost 60 years. At the general election in 2005, the party's majority was over 13,500, so it's not hard to understand why the other parties haven't tried hard here until now, with Gordon Brown's popularity at an all-time low and the new SNP government in Scotland. It seems all the parties think it's worth having a go. But what do the locals think?
Well, the stupid leaflets and that is coming through the doors. My face has never halted all week at the door.
The phone calls are worse because you're actually maybe doing something, you're busy. You've got about six leaflets at the door, you've took in, put them in the bin, and actually the phone goes, you're running in because you think it's family members and it's them on the phone again.
Every day I've been talking to a lot of them, so no going to vote now because they're fed up with it.
The local minister thinks there's been too much attention.
We know that they're in glad-handing and then walking out again. It's part of the process that we've come to expect. And it is patronising, particularly, as I said, if people aren't taking the issues here seriously, which we haven't seen in the past.
But could a healthy interest be good for the area?
The people in the East End feel that they are painted as being the sick men of Britain. And on this occasion, that there's been lots of interest in hearing what the problems actually are.
But while the parties were everywhere, there were some people missing. There's been no sign of the Prime Minister or the Chancellor. Despite all the running around, realistically tonight, there are only two contenders in the race, Labour and the SNP. In 2005, just under half of this constituency voted, but with the summer holidays, even fewer are expected to turn out. And in Glasgow East, this is sure to be crucial.
Well, we've heard from Nicola Sturgeon and Douglas Alexander. We're now joined by Jon Swinson, MP for the Scottish Liberal Democrats, and the Deputy Leader of the Scottish Conservatives, the MSP, Murdo Fraser. All of you, welcome. We've got a full panel now. We've got everyone lined up. Murdo Fraser, so the Tory party is big back, bold in Scotland?
Of course, Glasgow East is not natural Tory.
I thought you'd say
territory.
Yes to that. I thought you'd say yes to that.
Of course, we're back in business in Scotland. This is not natural Tory territory. There are 421 parliamentary seats we don't hold in Westminster. On that list, Glasgow East is number 402 in our target list. So it's not natural Tory territory. At the last general election, we came fourth here with roughly half the votes the Liberal Democrats got, who came third. However, we ran a great campaign. We had a superb candidate in Davina Rankin, who really built up her profile as a media performer during this campaign, and we got a great reception. Now, I remember the days when you would take your life in your hands walking around Glasgow East wearing a blue rosette. This time we had people actually listening to what we had to say, and we've really got the Tories back on the map. Now, what will happen in terms of votes? We'll have to wait and see, because, of course, the difficulty we face, and this goes for the Liberal Democrats too, in a very tight two-horse race by-election, which all the pundits called us for, the danger is if you're in third or fourth place, your vote gets squeezed, because your people start tactically voting for the person who, in this case, probably they think is best placed to beat Labour. So we'll need to wait and see how we're doing, but we've run an excellent campaign with a very good reception, and we are confident our vote's holding up.
Your vote's holding up, but this is David Cameron's Conservative Party that, according to the polls, is 20 points plus ahead of the Labour Party. You did well in Crewe and Nantwich, you did well in Henley, you've seen everybody else off. Shouldn't you be doing better in Scotland?
Well, we did fantastically in Crewe and Nantwich, a 17.6% swing from Labour to the Conservatives in a seat where we were the challengers. We were not the challengers in this seat. We're starting from a base where we were in fourth place at the general election. So, this is not a seat where people would naturally switch to us as the people best placed to beat the Labour candidate. But I'm still confident we'll have done well, and a very good result for us will be beating the Liberal Democrats and coming third.
OK, so that's your benchmark. That's what success will mean.
That would be a great result for us tonight to come third.
Right, OK, so you've set the benchmark. Jo Swinson, I drove around the constituency today. I didn't see much sign of a Liberal Democrat bandwagon anywhere.
Well, we've certainly had a dedicated team of activists that have been campaigning in Glasgow East, and I was out there myself this morning delivering leaflets early in the day to set polling day off to a good start. I think we've had a good campaign with a fantastic candidate, and in fact most of the independent commentators watching the debates with all the parties' candidates have consistently said that Ian Robertson has been a real star and done brilliantly. But as Murdo said, it's a difficult situation when you're in third or fourth place. We were third at the general election, we were fourth in 2007 at the Scottish elections in this seat when the Conservatives managed to get third place. So it has been more difficult.
I've covered by-elections where the Liberal Democrats have been in third place. They get a great head of steam going and they come through to win.
Well, in some by-elections we obviously do. And we've had a fabulous amount of by-election victories. Indeed, not too long ago in Dunfermline where we took the seat from Labour in their own backyard of Gordon Brown. But this has been a seat where we started from a very low base. We don't have a local government base or a network of particular activities. So I think in the time available, and let's recall also this has been a very quick campaign of just 3 weeks because Labour were so petrified that they would lose the seat that they called it absolutely as quickly as possible. And within that time, I think we've taken the message to the people of Glasgow East. We've listened to what they had to say on a lot of the main issues of the day rather than squabbling about independence or other things, actually listening to the issues about the fire station at Parkhead being threatened with closure, housing in the constituency, education, skills, all of these key issues. And I think that's what the people of Glasgow East will want their MP to focus on, whoever that is, once the result is announced.
Douglas Alexander, why was the by-election called so quickly?
Well, because we didn't want the people of Glasgow East to be left for several months without a candidate. It's necessary if a MP resigns as distinct from dies for there to be a process by which you move forward. It wouldn't have been an option to do that other than when Parliament returned. So if there hadn't been a quick move while Parliament was sitting, we would have been in a position where there would have been several months. It was exactly the same precedent as the Hamilton South by-election you mentioned a few minutes ago.
I asked you a little bit earlier whether Gordon Brown had been an asset and why we hadn't seen more of him either in leaflets, and you said he had been on leaflets, and yeah. I don't think that Nicola quite agreed. David Marshall, an asset, the ex-MP?
Well, he certainly built a huge support for Labour over many years working in the constituency. Clearly, there are health issues which explain the fact that he's had to stand down from the seat. But if you look at the vote that he's secured over many years representing people in Glasgow East, then that tells its own story.
So you think he has been a big asset?
Well, as I say, he clearly hasn't been well, which is why he's had to leave Parliament. And in that sense, he hasn't had an active role in the campaign.
Sure, no. Everyone understands that. But his face has been absolutely kind of wiped out of history, it seems, on every leaflet. If he was such a great record of such a great constituency MP, and I was up in Crewen Nantwich and saw what was happening with Gwyneth Dunwoodie, and she was, you know, her face was everywhere on the leaflets.
Yes, the circumstances were rather different, John.
Of course, but where David Marshall's name has barely been mentioned.
Yes, in Crewen Nantwich, I was there, of course, you had a figure who had represented the seat similarly for a number of years, who tragically died and whose daughter was the candidate. That was why Tamsin Dunwoodie was very keen to talk about her mother. That's rather different circumstances from where a long-standing Member of Parliament, on the basis of personal reasons related to his health, chooses to stand down. That doesn't seem to me to be particularly contentious point.
It's not contentious that he's stood down, and I'm not making anything of that. Yeah. I'm just intrigued about why, if you're saying to me, which you are saying, that he did such a great job in building up support and helping Labour, why he has been totally anonymous from the campaign.
Well, because
in terms of his record, in terms of his photos on leaflets.
I think the circumstances are very different from Crewen Nantwich, which is the example you cited, because clearly we were keen to talk up the fact that the tradition of service to that constituency, we wanted to continue with Tamsin. The fact is, the issues that have been discussed in this election, I think, focus more on Margaret's candidacy. I think she has been, by any reckoning, an outstanding and strong candidate for the East End of Glasgow. And I think she's run an exemplary campaign.
Nicola Sturgeon, are you going to say that John Mason is the greatest candidate in this, because compared to some of the big firebrands you've had, the Jim Sillers and the like, he hasn't kind of doesn't set the heather alight, I think is the phrase.
For the last 10 years, John Mason has been a councillor within the Glasgow East constituency, and at the local government elections last May, he got more votes than any councillor of any party in the whole of the city of Glasgow. So I think that speaks volumes for not what I think of John Mason, and I think he has been a tremendous candidate, but it speaks volumes for what people in that constituency think of John Mason. And one consistent theme of any canvassing I've done over the past 3 weeks has been the high regard in which he's held by people right across the constituency.
Your leader, Alex Salmond, has sought to make this about this is a battle between Alex Salmond, me, and Gordon Brown.
I don't think he's ever said that. What he has said is, firstly, that this was an opportunity for voters in Glasgow East, if they so wish, to send a very strong message to Gordon Brown on issues like the rising cost of living, fuel prices and food prices. And he's also said that it is an opportunity for people to cast a verdict on the unpopular Labour government in London versus, if I say so myself, the popular SNP government in Holyrood. I think that's a perfectly legitimate choice to have cast for people, and we'll see what the verdict is later on.
Isn't the most damning charge, Douglas Alexander, that you hear on the ground is that, yeah, Labour have been in power here a very long time in Glasgow East. What have they done for us?
Yes, and that's why I felt that the kind of coverage that the constituency received, particularly after the speech that was focused on in your film that David Cameron made, was so unfortunate, because that precipitated a kind of wave of negative publicity about the east end of Glasgow, which simply denied some of the basic facts in terms of the number of new primary schools that have been built in recent years, the fact that unemployment has been cut in half since 1997, the fact that the benefit rule is going down, the fact that we are seeing sustained investment in the housing stock in Glasgow. All of those achievements were simply ignored by many within the media, and actually part of the reason that I think Margaret's been so effective as a candidate was that she was determined to stand up for the east end of Glasgow rather than see it talked down.
I just wonder, Murdo, what you think that David Cameron's speech was a help or hindrance to you that he made, because it certainly seemed to give a tougher edge to the Conservative Party, kind of not much, so less of the caring conservatism.
I think he was absolutely right, and of course it's very unfortunate some of the way in which his message has been twisted by other political parties. Really what he was saying was, in a constituency like Glasgow East, and indeed many other constituencies across the country, government needs to help people, but of course people also have personal responsibility, and we shouldn't forget about that. And actually, I found in Glasgow East, people actually agree with that fundamental message. That's exactly what he was saying. And it is a bit of an indictment of Labour. Labour have been in power in Glasgow East for, what, 60 years? They've run the council here for 50-odd years. You know, Labour can't just say these are all somebody else's problems. There's been a Labour MP for many years, a Labour government at Westminster, and a Labour executive in Holyrood for 8 years until, of course, the election last year. Labour can't just say this is all somebody else's fault. They've got to take responsibility for some of the things that have gone wrong, and that's exactly what David Cameron was pointing out.
OK, all of you, we'll come back to a lot of these issues, but I mean, I'm just interested, Glenn, what you think about the battle of the candidates. I know you had them on a Newsnight special last week about who were the best performers.
Well, I think, as Jo Swinson said earlier, Ian Robertson has been singled out as a bit of a star of this by-election, although I think he himself would concede that the Liberal Democrats don't have any real hope of winning here. Perhaps in future that's a name we should watch out for, maybe being selected for a more winnable Liberal Democrat seat. I think the Conservative candidate, Davina Rankin, has also grown in confidence throughout this campaign. But I guess we are talking about a battle here between Labour and the SNP, between Margaret Curran and John Mason. And sometimes it's been difficult to call the debates between them. Perhaps overall, as a personality, Margaret Curran has edged it, but sometimes she's talked too much and too long and left herself open to the occasional gaffe.
What, a politician speak too long? Inconceivable. But on that, I mean, isn't it interesting, though, that you can have the greatest candidate in the world, but if a by-election is going to be decided on bigger issues, national issues and those sort of things, then, frankly, you can be the best candidate and still come nowhere.
That's right, and I think there has been a lot of national politics in this campaign. David Cameron, again, not expecting to win in Glasgow East, has used the constituency as a backdrop for his national UK-wide campaigning. He described this as a by-election, the Broken Society by-election, which was interpreted by Labour as talking down to the East End of Glasgow. Do you think, Professor John Curtice, that this has been a contest fought on local issues, or is it more a battle between Alex Salmond and Gordon Brown, a sort of popularity contest?
Well, I think it's actually one of the most remarkable things about this by-election, given the big apparent national backdrop, is the degree to which, at least manifestly, the campaign has been about local issues. In a sense, that's an element where the Labour Party seemed to have been relatively successful. Their campaign slogan for Margaret Cohen was standing up for the East End, in a sense almost mimicking the SNP slogan of the past of standing up for Scotland. She said very much focusing on Margaret Cohen as somebody who would stand up for the East End of Glasgow and would try to improve the lives of people living in the East End. Virtually no mention of Westminster. Interesting, I think the SNP rather struggled until rather late in the campaign to get the Scottish dimension into it, i.e. to get people to think about, well, who do you think is a better politician, Alex Salmond or Gordon Brown? Now, it may well be true, despite all of Labour's efforts and despite, as it were, all the manifest politicking between the candidates being about local issues, perhaps at the end of the day, that national backdrop has proved to be the crucial influence.
Well, no doubt they're chewing over the campaign issues, the things that have played in this by-election contest. I think that's perhaps Ian Davidson there, the MP for one of the neighbouring constituencies, and certainly the Electoral Commissioner for Scotland, newly appointed John McCormick in what looks like a green tweed jacket there. The count well underway now in Glasgow East at Toll Cross, and that result perhaps coming in any time from 12:30 onwards. Just wanted to reflect on some of the comments we heard a little bit earlier, Angus. Nicola Sturgeon saying this by-election is on a knife edge, and Douglas Alexander saying that it has been a tough fight. And I don't know, what did you think? Sounding pretty downbeat?
I thought he sounded very downbeat. I think the whole message coming from about 2 o'clock this afternoon from people in the Labour Party has been one of growing despondency. The SNP have been cautious, though. The SNP have been careful not to say, you know, we're in the lead or we're heading for glory on this one. So my feeling tonight is that it will still be absolutely close. I mean, we could be talking about a couple of hundred votes, but my feeling, just talking to a lot of Labour people in the run-up coming here tonight, they don't now really, I think, expect to win it.
How different is a by-election midterm, John Curtice, compared with the general election battle?
Well, it's very different. I mean, the first rule, in a sense, of by-elections is certainly when governments are in trouble, the swing against them is usually much greater in by-elections than it is in opinion polls at the current point in time. So, for example, even currently in Scotland, even though we've just recently had the first opinion poll to put the SNP ahead in people's voting intentions for a Westminster election as opposed to a Holyrood election, where the SNP are always more popular. Now, the swing in that opinion poll since the last election, when, by the way, the SNP did very badly in the last Westminster election, the swing in that was 13%. Now, even if the Labour Party win it, but it's close, it looks as though we're talking about a swing in this by-election of 20% plus, much bigger than even in the most recent pretty poor opinion poll Scotland-wide for Labour. So the thing about by-elections is that people will use these by-elections in a sense to send a protest note to Westminster, and that therefore it results in a much bigger defeat for the government party than you would expect if this were a general election.
But you say the governing party, of course, as we've been pointing out, two governing parties, and they are the main contenders.
That's right, but I think the crucial thing to realise is that whereas, as it were, 12 months of Gordon Brown has been 12 months in which both his personal ratings and that of his government have been in free fall, the first 12 months or so of the SNP government has been an occasion when Alex Salmond has maintained, if not enhanced, his popularity, and when the SNP clearly remain ahead of Labour, when we get opinion polls asking people how they'd vote in Scottish Parliament election. The first 12 months of the SNP government, at least politically, in terms of impressing the electorate, has been a success, whereas the first 12 months of Gordon Brown's premiership, so far as the wider public's been concerned, has been little short of a disaster.
Angus McLeod, I guess a win for the SNP would ensure that the seemingly never-ending honeymoon for Alex Salmond continues, and more bad news for Gordon Brown. You were a contemporary of his at university. Mm-hmm. You know the man, the character. What's gone wrong?
I've never really been in the among those who thought that Gordon Brown was one of nature's prime ministers. I mean, I think that to be prime minister in the modern political era, you have to have a certain amount of ability to connect with people. You have to show a relevant amount of, if you like, empathy. I mean, I'm talking about people like Bill Clinton, Barack Obama, and dare I mention his name in the context of Gordon Brown, Tony Blair. And I just don't think that Gordon Brown has that pizzazz. I don't think he has that ability to connect. I think actually he's the wrong man in the wrong job, quite frankly, and I think the chickens are coming home to roost because of that.
Thanks both for the moment. Throughout this by-election, the people of Glasgow East could have been forgiven for thinking that this campaign had more to do with the Prime Minister's future than it did with theirs. Speculation has been rife. If Gordon Brown can't hang on to one of Labour's safest seats, what can he hang on to? Here's James Cook.
The way it's been seen at Westminster, the national picture, is the third part of what may turn out to be a trilogy, if you want, in the tragic demise of Gordon Brown's leadership.
Just waiting for everybody to be in position.
If this is a trilogy, then it opened on this stage. True and Nantwich, safe Labour territory since the Second World War.
Edward Timpson, Conservative, 20,539.
It was a measure of the upset that the man who'd spent a decade boasting of his economic success resorted to blaming the economy.
The message of the British public is clear and unequivocal. They want us to address these challenges, and I believe that I can do so, and that is the task that I've set for myself, that we take this economy through difficult times.
But was he the man to take on that task? Some Labour MPs didn't sound so sure.
We have, I think, until the end of the year to change direction in order to give ourselves the prospects of winning back the confidence in the electorate. And if we don't do it by the end of the year, I think it's the end of the pier.
And I hereby declare that John Michael Howell has been duly elected Member of Parliament for the Henley constituency.
And this was part two of the trilogy. True blue territory this time, but Labour barely scraped 1,000 votes in Henley, losing their deposit and finishing fifth behind the BNP.
Today, the British public has sent a message to Gordon Brown: get off our backs, stop the endless tax rises, and help us cope with the rising cost of living.
And so to the third part of the trilogy and Glasgow East. But what will be the ending? Will tonight be a dark night for Gordon Brown?
And this is seen at Westminster as Gordon Brown's Scottish Labour heartlands and a test of whether he can hold even his heartland seat. The argument being, this was set out very clearly by Labour people at the start of the campaign, if Gordon Brown's party cannot hold a seat like Glasgow East, then Gordon Brown simply cannot deliver what they need at the next election. And that could be the catalyst for a move within the party to oust him. Clearly, it's not going to be a big majority, even if they do win it. And what they'd have to do after a victory, I think, is take the summer to retrench, to think about what's going wrong. Gordon Brown clearly needs some time off, some rest, because he's not been giving himself enough of that, to take a more strategic look about how he needs to get his leadership back on track.
He may get that chance even sooner. Tomorrow, the Prime Minister meets union leaders at a key summit in Warwick. Perhaps that will be the opportunity to signal a change of direction.
James Cook reporting. Well, let's talk now. The former leader of the Liberal Democrats, Angus Campbell, is in our Edinburgh studio. Do you think Gordon Brown's job is on the line as a result of this by-election?
I don't think it's as a result of this by-election. I think you've got to look back to that day when he finally decided he wasn't going to call a general election last October, having allowed a lot of expectation to build up. And ever since then, I think he has struggled, first of all, to demonstrate the kind of self-confidence which is necessary in both leadership and also as the Prime Minister of a government. And of course, since troubles never come singly, he's found himself against the backdrop of Northern Rock and, of course, the inflationary pressures caused by the rise in food prices and in oil as well. So he made, I think, a cardinal error which has been compounded by the circumstances which have surrounded him since then.
And is he the ditherer that he's made out to be?
I don't believe so. I mean, it's no secret. He's a friend of mine. I've known him for a very long time. I don't believe he's a ditherer. I think he's someone who, and it's perhaps not very fashionable these days, judging by some of what's just being said about what's necessary by way of pizzazz. But he's someone who thinks about issues and tries rationally to arrive at the proper conclusion. Difficulty was over the idea of a general election. He thought about it and arrived at the wrong conclusion. But he's not a ditherer. I mean, that's an effort being made by the Conservatives. I don't regard him in that light at all.
OK, if he reflects upon this result and if the SNP take this, Labour's third safest seat in Scotland, will he conclude that the game's up and he should walk away, or is he in this at least until the next UK-wide general election?
Well, I'm tempted to say that's a question you should ask him. But I know what would happen if you asked him the question. He would tell you, as he's been saying, that he's going to take matters through. And I, myself, looking at the other possible contenders on the Labour Party front bench in the House of Commons, I don't see anyone yet who has the capacity to mount a successful challenge. Subject to this, remember, and it's how Mrs. Thatcher finally came to meet her political demise in the House of Commons. Once the colleagues begin to worry, not about policy or about the direction of the government, but once they begin to worry about the safety of their own seats, that's the point at which, to use John Prescott's famous phrase, the plates begin to shift.
And is that not happening widely already at Westminster among Labour MPs?
No, it's a very curious atmosphere. Now, you may have noticed one or two reflective articles by political commentators over the last couple of days, because we've just entered the long parliamentary summer recess. There's a kind of curious mood about some Labour MPs, some fatalistic, it's all up, we've just got to get through until 2010 and hope that something may turn up. Others more optimistic, others neither one nor the other. There is not yet the kind of concerted move against Gordon Brown which characterised the Conservative Party when it came to Mrs. Thatcher and when it came to the poll tax.
Well, Douglas Fraser in our film suggesting that a bad by-election result here could be the catalyst for that kind of decline. Let me ask you about the Liberal Democrats, though. Is it good for the Lib Dems that Gordon Brown stays on, hangs on?
Well, what's good for the Lib Dems is that we put a candidate up in this, what was for us always going to be a difficult by-election, because by the nature of things, by the nature of previous results, by the nature of the focus that you've just been discussing at some length, this was always going to be between Labour and the SNP. We put up a cracking good candidate. Indeed, I think you yourself a moment or two ago rather conceded that he'd been the best of the bunch. We've shown that in difficult circumstances like Glasgow East, we can run effective campaigns, that we have got bright young people who want to stand on behalf of the Liberal Democrats, and that there's no such thing as a no-go area for our party anywhere, from, if you like, the Scilly Isles in the southwest to Orkney and Shetland in the north.
Sir Angus Campbell, thanks very much indeed.
Let's
cross straight now to Tollcross Leisure Centre and our reporter Aileen Clarke for an update. Aileen.
Well, it's certainly not getting any less tense here, that's for sure. I can give you the turnout figure now. We've now got it. It's 42.25. So that's a turnout, 42.25. So less than it was in the general election, certainly more than some were predicting for this. Interesting, you've been talking about Gordon Brown there. I was asking the Labour camp if, you know, Gordon Brown's performance was an issue on the doorstep. Now, what I was hearing was that it was more people were worried about the economy, worried about the price of food, for example, than actually worried about the Prime Minister. Though I must add, somebody then said to me in the Labour camp, mind you, the luck Gordon Brown's having, I think at the moment he could probably open up a funeral parlour and folk would stop dying. So that gives you some kind of an idea of what the feeling is there. But also interesting bits of tittle-tattle from the floor. The Conservatives believe that they're going to take third place here, which of course would mean the Liberal Democrats would be in fourth place, and I think the Liberal Democrats have resigned themselves to the fact that they would be in fourth place. Now, it looks like we could have a result here, I would say, perhaps within the next hour. It's looking good for a result within the next hour, so we should know all the figures before too long.
fingers crossed. Thanks for the figures you've brought us so far, Aileen. And let's ask Professor John Curtice about that confirmed turnout figure, just over 42%. What do you read into that?
Well, I think the first thing to say, of course, this is a constituency which traditionally has very low turnout. It was only 48% in the general election. So that, of course, means, in fact, the drop is only one of 6 percentage points. And I think you have to go back to the Glasgow Hill Head by-election of 1982 to find a by-election where apparently the electorate have been energised by a by-election such that the turnout is something approaching that in a general election. I think what we might perhaps read, the first thing to say is that clearly, despite the fact this by-election was held in the middle of the Glasgow Fair holiday, it has energised an electorate that has not so far been used to having tough election campaigns. It's therefore, that's probably helped to bring people to the polls.
Does it tell you whose voters have come out, especially given some of the evidence that there's been a bit of a last-minute surge?
It doesn't tell you who. I think all I would say is that given that the SNP did put in a very substantial organisational effort, maybe perhaps we're seeing some indication of that effort paying off, and that certainly I think if there weren't a relatively high turnout, we wouldn't be thinking about the possibility at all of the SNP winning the seat. I think the SNP needed a relatively high turnout, and that this may be an indication that their organisational effort has indeed paid off.
Okay, let's cross to the other John now. Jon Sopel is with the panel, and dear me, Gordon Brown's future on the line. What do you think?
Oh, it's a very, very big question. It's one that's going to be exercised and chewed over, and I can't imagine how many trees are going to be felled to fill column inches with this, because we've also got here a panel to provide us with expert analysis and assess what all of this means for the Prime Minister in particular. Joined by one of Labour's rising stars, the leader of Glasgow City Council, Stephen Purcell. Thank you very much for being with us. The broadcaster and journalist Fiona Ross, who rather unkindly reminded me that we covered a by-election together some 20 years ago in Glasgow Central. The political commentator Jerry Hassan, and Murray Ritchie, who's the former political editor of The Herald and also was the former convener of the Scottish Independence Convention. All of you, thank you very much indeed for being with us. Stephen Purcell, let me come to you as leader of Glasgow City Council. Do you think Gordon Brown is now a liability to the Labour Party?
No, I do not. And it's clear there's going to be a very tight result in this by-election, and we'll know the result shortly. It's clear to me, as someone who's been campaigning vigorously over the last few weeks in the East End of Glasgow, that the economy is a big issue.
Well, that was his great success story.
People have, and because it was his biggest success story, and now we're going through an international turmoil in terms of economic times, I believe he has the nerve and the strength of character and the financial acumen to lead the country through this. And what we need to do as a party is convince the electorate that that's the case.
We heard some of the discussion there that, you know, you've got to be a good communicator in this media age. You've got to have the ability to reach out and have a bit of sort of maybe be sprinkled with some of that Obama magic. Gordon Brown seems to be somewhat lacking in that department.
Well, I think anyone that knows the Prime Minister knows that he's a very genuine man, he's a very intelligent man and a very capable man, and that he is, whenever you're in his company, he is very capable of giving you a bit of that magic, of making you feel that he is the right man to lead this country through the turbulent times that the world is living in.
It's a very interesting point you make there, that if you meet him personally and you know him, and I've heard this so many times from people who know him, say he's warm and he's... But that doesn't come across. I mean, isn't that the problem, that it's left to you for people to say, if only you knew the Gordon Brown that I knew?
Well, presentation is important in modern politics. There's no doubt about that, because we live in a 24-hour media world. And I think we do need to do more as a party to convince people that the Prime Minister is the right man to lead the country through this difficult period.
Hang on, that's an important quote. You need to do more as a party to convince the nation that Gordon Brown is the right man to lead this country.
I think we do. I mean, there's no point in denying that there have been bad election results in parliamentary by-election, in the English local results. And we know that in this very traditionally safe Labour seat, that there's a very close result tonight. But there's a very serious issue about how people are feeling about the economy, their future and their family's future. And I am utterly convinced that it's Gordon Brown and not David Cameron that would be better to lead this country through that period.
Jerry Hassan, how do you see it for Gordon Brown?
It's not very good. And one of the chickens coming home to roost for Gordon Brown is basically the fact there wasn't a contest for the leadership last year. But one of the cultural things the Labour Party has, in the last 45 years of Labour, there's only been one challenge to a Labour leader, and that was the kamikaze attempt by Benn against Kinnock, as you remember, in 1988. So it's still true that the Labour Party has a culture of not standing against their existing leaders. And I think even though Brown's pushing that to breaking point, it still holds true.
Right. Fiona, what happens if Labour loses tonight? And we just still don't know. We've only just got the turnout figure. We've still got a little way to go. But if Labour does lose this seat?
Well, it's disastrous, obviously. If you're asking me what it means in terms of Gordon Brown, I don't think it really means very much for Gordon Brown immediately. I mean, prime ministers have lost by-elections before. I also think there is a lot of muttering, you know, people apparently in the Labour Party saying we've got to do something about Gordon Brown, but who exactly is going to do it? As far as I can see, there is not a lineup of cabinet colleagues. I mean, I don't think Douglas Alexander is actually battering on Gordon Brown's door saying you've got to go.
I tell you what I promise you, I'll ask him that in a moment.
I suspect you're the answer.
Yeah, it would be a world exclusive if he turned around and said, yeah, I told him this evening, Gordon, it's up. But I don't think we're going to get that. On the flavour of what I've heard
I've
so far.
I've got a lot of doors this evening, but that's not one of them.
Murray Ritchie, before we bring Douglas Alexander properly into this discussion, I want to hear from you what you think a by-election defeat means. Is Fiona right that it just means, well, you know what? Governments lose by-elections when they're unpopular.
Well, they do. I don't think that Gordon Brown will step down immediately tomorrow if the SNP win tonight. Or I don't think he'll do that anytime soon. He's not that kind of guy. He'll be hanging on with his famous fingernails onto the premiership for some time to come. And as Angus McLeod said earlier, he's got until, well, the best part of 2 years now to try and do something about his problems. What baffles me about Gordon Brown is why he's not doing it now. I mean, he's a competent, intelligent, experienced politician, and everybody around him is saying you're getting things wrong. Why don't you do something that the people like? Why don't you change tack? And he doesn't appear to have an immediate challenger. There's not exactly a queue of charismatic Labour cabinet ministers waiting to take him on as in a challenge. So the field is open for him to do something about this, but he doesn't seem to be doing it. There seems to be a sort of stasis. You know?
Okay, let us. Douglas Alexander, you're not going to give us the world exclusive, I know. Have you beaten a path to his door and told him he should quit?
No.
Right. Do you think there is a problem with his leadership? As we were hearing there from Stephen, that maybe he doesn't communicate that well.
OK, let's deal with the facts in terms of where we are as a party, and then let's deal with Gordon as the individual. As a party, we're clearly in the midterm of a third term. That's always going to be tough. In addition to that, we are coping with what, even 3 or 4 months ago, people, I think, were more likely to say are inevitably the government's problems. But people are coming to realise are actually global problems, whether that's rising fuel prices, rising food prices, the difficulties in terms of mortgages. That's not to say that the pain people are feeling is not just as real. But on the other hand, those challenges are real. So inevitably, we're going to face challenges as a political party at that stage. The real question, it seems to me, therefore, is who is the individual who has the best experience, the best knowledge, ability, skills to actually address those problems? And I share Stephen's view, communication and presentation matters in politics, but actually results and delivery matters more, I would argue, particularly as an incumbent power looking to deliver for people and asking people to vote for you for a third or fourth term.
Well, let me pick up on the Murray point, which is why does he seem to keep making the wrong choices? And, you know, I could go through sections of the year where, you know, he goes to Iraq, it seemed to be political dealing during the Tory party conference. There's the 10 pence tax ban, which he says isn't going to affect that many people, refuses to accept it, then he does, and then you have to introduce a £2.7 billion measure to correct it. And you could go on and on with a whole series of things where it just does seem that Gordon Brown has ended up on the wrong side of the argument.
But equally, you could argue that while we're seeing what the IMF itself calls the biggest challenge to the global economy since the Great Depression, the 63rd quarter of sustained economic growth, continued employment at a high level in the country. You could say that in terms of the policies he's been rolling out in England, for example, because health, of course, has devolved here in Scotland, access to GP services, there's a whole range of policy choices that Gordon's been making in the course of the last year, which I actually believe speak to what Murray said, which is this is a serious, substantial politician who's making the right long-term choices. Now, are there immediate quick fixes for the fact that the price of oil's gone from about $10 or $30 a barrel to $135 or $145? Of course there's not. The answer surely is to say, let's set a course to sustain the economic stability and sustain the economic growth and manage towards that, at the same time as seeking to address the concerns that people have, whether it's in relation to knife crime, whether it's in relation to health or education. And I tell you what's going on, but Gordon, you know, Brown's
then,
going
then
on.
You mentioned knife crime, and obviously there's been a huge amount of concern over that, and then we suddenly get a story that Gordon Brown is going to recommend that the people who've committed knife crimes go and visit the victims in hospital. And then that idea gets ditched. It blew in and it blew out
well,
as
I'll
an idea.
Responsibility for the Labour government. I can't accept responsibility for every headline of every newspaper. The idea of restorative justice, whereby people actually confront the consequences of their crime, is hardly a new or particularly innovative idea. I actually think it's one of the approaches that we need, as well as the rollout of neighbourhood policing, to actually tackle what's a real problem.
Nicola Sturgeon, have you been surprised by Gordon Brown as Prime Minister?
Yes and no. I mean, I can't remember who it was earlier on who said that they hadn't had any great expectations of Gordon Brown as an actual Prime Minister. I put myself in that camp. I never was entirely convinced that he would step up to that top job and be an instant success. I suppose where I've been surprised is just how inept he has turned out to be. And, you know, Douglas talks partially correctly about the global economic circumstances, because of course a lot of what we are experiencing just now is global. But I think many people feel two things. Firstly, that Gordon Brown's decade as Chancellor did nothing to prepare the country for the downturn we're facing now. But secondly, that some of the decisions he's taking now are totally the wrong decisions. You know, faced with an economic downturn, Gordon Brown decides to double the lowest rate of tax, which hits the most vulnerable hardest. He's doing nothing at all about the rising cost of fuel and could do something as
well,
his tax
I'm
take
sure,
goes
I'm
up.
I'm sure he'd say, look, that's
so
what...
Well, it's not wrong.
But Nicola,
it is
wrong. What about the increase in the winter fuel payment? What about the fact that Alistair Darling said last September and then again in April that the cost of fuel was not going to rise in line with inflation, but was actually
Alistair
going
Darling,
to be
frozen Alistair Darling, in the course of this by-election
payment.
Campaign, under pressure from the SNP, decided to postpone an increase. He didn't actually
reduce
the cost.
So it was the SNP who forced
the
I mean,
well,
come on,
yes,
Nicola,
actually,
let's
Douglas,
be serious.
Think,
the election's over. You can tell the truth.
I think the truth is that if it hadn't been for this by-election, we wouldn't have had that decision in the course of the last week.
So why had he already
but
frozen
anyway,
it back in April?
Well, he said he wouldn't take the second decision until October, and suddenly it was brought forward. Now, we can argue about the reason for that all night. But the other point is that did nothing to lower the cost of fuel for people who are really feeling the pinch. And that's where Gordon Brown is letting people down and letting them down badly.
Nicola Sturgeon, do you believe that, I mean, we keep on saying, we don't have a result of this by-election and Labour may win, the SNP may win, and who knows it, who else could possibly conceivably win this by-election at this stage in the evening. But if the SNP have won, does it make any difference to how long Gordon Brown stays at number 10 in your view?
You know, the matter of Gordon Brown's leadership is, in the first instance, a matter for the Labour Party. But there is absolutely no doubt that either a win for the SNP tonight or a substantial swing towards the SNP is disastrous for Gordon Brown. It's disastrous for the Labour Party, but it's good for Scotland and it's good for Glasgow, because it makes sure our voice is heard and it makes sure, I think, that some of the changes people want to see are more likely rather than less likely.
Murdo Fraser, you said when we came to you that a good result would be for you to come third. Who would you prefer came first?
Oh, I think it's a disaster for Labour, whatever happens.
No, I said, who would you rather see win? Which is a worse result for the Conservative Party?
I was campaigning for the Conservative candidate. I want to see the Conservative candidate win this election. I'm not going to judge between the lesser of two evils, between Labour and the SNP. If Labour hold on here, and they might just hold on, it's still a disaster for Gordon Brown. He can take no comfort from this if they hold on by a few hundred votes. And let's not forget that, you know, Gordon Brown was nowhere to be seen during this election campaign. He didn't appear on Margaret Curran's leaflets. He wasn't mentioned by Margaret Curran at all during this election campaign. Margaret Curran and the Labour Party in Scotland did their darndest to keep Gordon Brown out of the picture because they knew he was an electoral liability. And if the SNP do win, and they might do, you know, the Conservatives showed in Crewe and Nantwich where we're the challengers, we can win the seat. It's up to the SNP tonight to prove that where they're the challengers, they can win a seat from Labour. If they do win, it'll be a disaster for Gordon Brown.
What about the economic argument that we've just heard Douglas Alexander make, that actually any government of any colour, and not just in Britain, around the world, is facing these twin problems of rising commodity prices, rising costs of food, the subprime problem, and oil?
Well, that argument might have some currency, had it not been for the fact that for the last 10 years, Gordon Brown has told us all that the economic success Britain has been down to him and him alone. Remember the old slogan, no return to boom and bust? Well, we've had a boom, and now it looks like we're heading for a bust. So Gordon Brown can't take the credit when things are going well, and then when things turn badly, say, it's nothing to do with me, mate. It's all the international circumstances. He's got to take some responsibility for this, and he has done absolutely nothing since this international crisis has blown up to try and alleviate the problems facing people in Britain, such as, for example, tackling the high cost of fuel, which are hitting hard-working families here in Glasgow East and right across the country.
Joe, I promise I'm going to bring you in a minute. I just want Douglas Alexander to respond to that. Don't you think it just does alienate people and turn people off politics, that when we have had Gordon Brown taking all the credit for the economic success of the past 10 years, and then saying, when it all goes south, nothing to do with me, Gov.
Those words have never crossed his lips, Joe.
Well, I characterise it slightly. Come
Douglas,
on, you
say
know
that
exactly
with a straight
what I'm
face
saying.
Again.
You are the one who said that the economic downturn is purely down to the fact that we have got rising oil prices and the credit crunch.
No, it is undeniable that right around the world there are those factors, whether it be rising commodity prices, rising food prices, rising oil that you've described. The challenge for us as a British government is to accept the responsibility of dealing with the consequences of that. That's why, if you look, for example, at Spain, where they've got a million houses, if we'd been having this conversation 6 months ago, Nicola would have said, let's look at the arc of prosperity round about Scotland, look at Iceland, look at Ireland. Why is it Ireland's heading for recession? Why is it Iceland's had a currency crisis? Why is it Britain's just enjoyed its 63rd quarter of economic growth? Why is it that we have maintained economic stability amidst all the global turbulence? Partly because of the choices we've made in terms of the macroeconomic framework, partly because we've pumped a commitment of £50 billion into the financial sector to be able to allow the mortgage market to stay open, partly because we've increased the payment for the winter fuel allowance, partly because we've frozen petrol duty. So we are acting in the face of the challenges that people face.
You'll be accusing people of being really ungrateful soon.
And you said you would only borrow to invest. What about the £2.7 billion that was unfunded?
Yes, and that's a reflection of the changing economic circumstances we face, whereby, over the cycle, we've always made clear that we will adhere to the rules.
Jo Swinson.
That's not a reflection of that at all. It was a reflection of the fact that the government realised it got itself into a hole by, for some reason, not doing the sums and thinking the voters wouldn't realise the 10p tax rate was going to leave some of the people on low and middle incomes worst off, and then having to try and dig themselves out of that hole during the Crewe and Nantwich by-election. It is true that there's global prices are increasing on fuel and on food, but where the government does need to take responsibility is that we are not well placed to weather that storm. Families are feeling the pinch. They're really struggling at the moment, and one of the reasons they're not well placed to deal with this is because there's now £1.4 trillion of personal debt in this country, and the growth, the economic growth over the past decade has largely been fueled by that cheap credit, which the Chancellor, Gordon Brown, as Chancellor then, actually encouraged. And there's been a lot of irresponsible lending that hasn't been cracked down upon, and it's going to leave a lot of misery for families up and down the country.
So I'd be the last person to deny that people are feeling the economic pain of those rising prices. But equally, I would say to you, the suggestion that's been made by at least two of the other panellists now that somehow 63 quarters of economic growth just happens by chance or by coincidence is, with the greatest respect, economically illiterate. Why have we not managed 63 quarters of economic growth in the past? The fact is, during those 63 quarters of economic growth, we have raised the skills level, not just here in Scotland, but across the United Kingdom. We've introduced modern apprenticeships. We've extended home ownership. These things didn't just happen, we made them happen, and those are the things which are equipping the British economy to cope with the very international factors I've been describing.
Yes, but you talked about the importance of good communication and being able to reach out to voters, and when they hear that you're saying that the 63 quarters, successive quarters of economic growth were down to us, but there are these global factors that we can't control, so if it goes bad, it's the world, if it goes well, it's us, and then there are other things, like you say, your response, for example, to the £2.7 billion that you spent to cover up the effects, you made that sound that that was a calm, rational response to the fact that there was a bit of a global economic downturn and we needed to invest, inject some money. It was because of the 10 pence tax rate and you were in a political hole.
Well, the 10 pence tax rate, which of course was part of a budget which saw a significant portion of the revenue raised committed through tax credits to the lowest income deciles within the country, it did lead to a reappraisal. There's no doubt, I'm not going to pretend otherwise, the Chancellor himself said so. And in that sense, there were steps taken. The reason he acted to give a tax cut of £120 to 22 million families was not simply to address and to provide compensation to people affected by the 10p rate, because otherwise he wouldn't have made it anything like as generous. It was a judgment made by Alistair Darling that it was the right time not simply to address the real and continuing concerns over 10p, but also to pump some more money into the economy along with the money we were putting in for tax credits. It is not exactly an unfamiliar economic approach to say when you see demand falling, you additionally increase demand into the economy.
All of you, we will come back to this. There are lots of shaking heads. I'm not sure how many of our panel you convinced, but I'm sure they'll have this.
I think they're a hard nut to crack.
Yeah, I know. But we've got a lot of time this evening. We'll see if that nut can be cracked. Glenn.
Thanks very much, John. We've been hearing from an SNP source within the last few minutes that things at the count are looking good. Well, let's cross there live now to the SNP's Westminster leader, Angus Robertson, who's MP for Moray. What does looking good mean?
It means that the SNP has had a very good day in Glasgow East. Of course, we shouldn't forget that this is rock-solid Labour territory, a majority of 13,500, a seat that the SNP has never made tremendous parliamentary progress in. But what we have learnt today, with the ballot boxes being opened, is that the SNP has made great strides. And it's made great strides because people in Glasgow East, as throughout Scotland, are pleased that we now have a Scottish government that is on their side. And they've also wanted to send a message to Gordon Brown that enough is enough, that we don't need and we don't want to go on with the kind of governance that we are seeing from Westminster. And that's why I think the SNP will enjoy a very good night. And what's more important than that is that it will hopefully bring about a result that will make a real difference to people in Glasgow East, whose voice will have to be listened to as far away as Downing Street.
Whatever people are voting on in Glasgow East, you're not seriously trying to tell me that independence has been way up there?
I don't know, every single Labour Party leaflet that was put out was highlighting our candidate, Councillor John Mason's commitment to independence. Everybody knows that that is what the SNP stands for, and we will give people that choice in a referendum. That was one of the issues of the campaign, but more than anything else, I think the cost of living was right at the top of people's agendas. And I think the fact that there was a clear contrast that the First Minister and SNP leader Alex Salmond was prepared to be in Glasgow East, talking and listening to people's concerns. And in contrast to that, we had Gordon Brown and the Chancellor of the Exchequer, Alistair Darling, both Scottish MPs, not setting ground in Glasgow East once. I think the contrast was very marked, and I think people, that helped make up people's minds that it was very, very obvious that it's the SNP that is on the side of the people, and the Labour Party have left people very, very far behind. I knocked on a lot of doors today, Glenn, and the thing that I heard time after time after time was not only that people are not voting Labour in this election, they were voting SNP, but they are never, ever voting Labour again. And that is one of the reasons why I think tonight's election in Glasgow East is so important.
OK, I know that you're being cautious and you're not telling us whether you're going to win. Can you tell us? And if not, is it going to be a four-figure majority?
No, I can't tell you at the moment, Glenn. We've only had the verification count and we're not certain exactly how the votes will tally. But I think we need to keep a sense of proportion before we know what the final result is and before speculating too much about it. This seat in Glasgow East has been represented almost without exception in the last 90 years by a Labour parliamentarian. Even the thought, even the notion that the Labour Party is going to lose this, their third safest seat in the country, would be a political earthquake. And I think the SNP is going to have a tremendous result tonight.
OK, well, we shall see. Thanks very much indeed, Angus Robertson, at the count. We've been joined in the studio now by Michael Crick, political editor of Newsnight, who's just joined us from the count. And, of course, you've spent a lot of time in the constituency. We should maybe spend a moment or two just talking about the the last MP, the man who sparked this by-election, Davy Marshall. He's been the MP for Glasgow East, or at least for the East End of Glasgow, since 1979, since Margaret Thatcher won. And in the last election in 2005, he was returned with a very comfortable majority. Davy Marshall with 18,775 votes for Labour. The SNP way behind in second place with just over 5,000 votes. So 60% of the vote going to Labour, the SNP with a paltry 17% by comparison. It would be something of an earthquake, would it not, if those statistics changed round?
It would. It's one of the safest Labour seats in Scotland and of course in the UK. And the scope for the SNP to turn it round, as you saw from those figures, has been all the tighter because the third and fourth parties, the votes there for the Liberal Democrats on about 11% and the Conservatives on about 7%. Normally in a by-election, the challenger hopes to squeeze the third and fourth parties. And that would make overturning the Labour majority all the greater. I think another reason why it will be all the greater of an achievement is that John Mason has probably not been the best of the candidates of the four in this constituency. I mean, arguably, he's been the weakest of the candidates. And Margaret Curran is, you know, quite a popular MSP, certainly from talking to many voters on the streets. And that makes it, you know, even more of an achievement. Did the SNP win this election tonight?
Now, you've been going round the polling stations in the constituency today. What have you picked up from speaking to voters?
Well, it's interesting. I mean, people are saying, look, this is going to be terribly bad news for Gordon Brown. I think actually it's more serious for the Labour Party because people are not saying we want to give Gordon Brown a kicking. There isn't the anger against Gordon Brown as an individual in this seat that I detected in Crewe and Nantwich, that I detected in the local elections in May. In fact, some people say they actually rather sympathise with Gordon Brown. They think he needs to be given more of a chance. And I think that actually helps when it comes to arguments about Gordon Brown's future. And, of course, at the start of the campaign, where people were saying that if Labour were to lose this seat, that would be the end of Gordon Brown as Prime Minister. I haven't actually subscribed to that view myself, and people haven't been saying it much in the last few days. But I think the nature of the campaign has not really been an anti-Gordon Brown campaign. In fact, a couple of voters said to me today they think that actually a lot of the anti-Gordon Brown stuff has come from Englishmen who don't like the fact he's Scottish and have sort of, backed him for that reason then.
I want to talk to you about Davy Marshall just a moment, but seeing we're talking Gordon Brown, you've been examining his poll ratings, and he really is a pretty unpopular Prime Minister.
He is a pretty unpopular Prime Minister, and I think give you some understanding of why we're talking about the possibility that Gordon Brown's tenure in town Downing Street might be weakened by this by-election result. The Labour Party has lost by-elections with majorities of that kind of size before. The Brent by-election, the Liberal Democrats spectacularly won. That had a 40% Labour majority. The Liberal Democrats won it. Tony Blair still remained in office.
OK, well, they've still got a lot of counting to do there at Glasgow East, and certainly lots of signs of activity, but no signs yet of nearing that result.
But the reason why Gordon Brown's tenure is potentially shaken by this kind of bad by-election result is that his own personal ratings are poor. For example, just take one poll out this week, it found that only 21% of people are satisfied with Gordon Brown as Prime Minister, 72% dissatisfied. Now, to give you some idea of, you know, how bad those figures are, only one previous Prime Minister has ever come up with worse figures than that. And that was John Major, who, of course, eventually fell to more serious defeat. Secondly, I think the problem that the Labour Party faces is that the argument the opposition have been putting forward, leaving aside Min Campbell, that Gordon Brown isn't up to the job, is something of a ditherer, that seems to have hit home with the electorate. Again, one poll earlier this month, 72% of people saying Gordon Brown's not up to the job, repeats a figure from another poll just a few weeks earlier. So the real problem is it's the electorate seem to have lost confidence in the Prime Minister, and that's why his position is perhaps potentially rather tenuous.
Now, you said that it hasn't, from your experience, been a major issue, Gordon Brown. Of course, there was an argument about whether Labour had even played the Brown card in the campaign. I can confirm one thing that Douglas Alexander said a little bit earlier. He has appeared on campaign literature. There's been a photograph of him on a leaflet pictured next to Margaret Thatcher when he invited her and welcomed her to Downing Street last year. The only problem, I suppose, is that that's actually on an SNP leaflet.
Yes, and Labour actually had this this leaflet, which I've got here myself as well, rather coming, because they'd been putting out a leaflet saying that there wasn't, that quoting John Mason as saying there wasn't much difference between a Labour government and a Tory government, and now the SNP have taken their revenge on the day when it was revealed that Gordon Brown or the Labour Party spent £140 on silverware for Margaret Thatcher on that particular visit to Downing Street. But the reason I say that is that when I spoke to voters today and on other days as to why they were switching from Labour to the SNP, or in one or two cases to the Conservatives, actually, they weren't saying, they weren't bringing up Gordon Brown as a reason. They had to be prompted by me. you know, what do you think of Gordon Brown? And whereas in other elections that in the last few weeks, people have brought up Gordon Brown and there's been an anger against him, which I haven't really detected here.
Well, the bundles are being arranged at the count. The votes are stacking up. The big question, of course, whether they're stacking up in favour of Labour, which has traditionally held the East End of Glasgow, or whether for the very first time in that part of the biggest city in Scotland, they're stacking up in favour of the SNP. If Gordon Brown hasn't been a major figure on the campaign trail or an issue on the campaign trail, what about David Marshall, who's been the MP for such a long time?
Well, strangely, he hasn't been an issue either. I mean, if you look at Labour's literature, I've gone through it pretty extensively. I couldn't find a single mention of David Marshall. There's no mention of him on Margaret Curran's website either. And yet, normally in by-elections, the subsequent candidate pays tribute to their predecessor and what a good MP they were, and so on. And there's an endorsement and so on. Now, admittedly, David Marshall has been ill and therefore hasn't been able to perhaps to give that kind of endorsement. Although he did issue a statement to Newsnight last night. But he has been airbrushed out of the campaign in much the same way that Gordon Brown isn't on the Labour Party literature either. Interestingly, David Marshall's house, when I visited it this week, didn't have any Labour posters on it either. It's almost as if, you know, he was never there, and yet up until 3.5 weeks ago he was the Member of Parliament for Glasgow East.
And you've been looking at his allowances and listening to some of the speculation about those, and perhaps that he might be worried about the publication of those later this year.
Well, he announced 3.5 weeks ago he was retiring from the Commons on the grounds of ill health. But a lot of people thought there was probably more to it than that. And I think a lot of the speculation at Westminster and indeed in Scottish politics as well was that he was worried about the publication of more details of MPs' allowances, which is due to happen in September, in particular, which MPs employ which members of their family. Now, it's said that Mr. Marshall employed his wife and possibly his daughter, both of whom are called Christina, but there's very little hard fact on this. There's also been a lot of speculation about his constituency office, which is actually in his constituency home.
And it's thought, did he claim expenses for that?
Well, it's thought that what happened there was that he claimed he claimed rent for it being a constituency office, which he then paid to himself as the owner of the property, which one or two other MPs do, or they, you know, when they hire a constituency office somewhere, then clearly they claim the cost of the rent on that office, and they hire the offices, I mean, often from the local Labour Party, actually, or from the council or an ordinary commercial office. In his case, the rent, it appears, was paid to him as the owner of that property. But strangely, Margaret Curran, who, after all, was the MSP for much of this constituency for the last 9 years, appears, when she was questioned by you on the Newsnight debate, and indeed yesterday when I questioned her on the street, appears not to have really known that this was his office, or indeed even to have visited
it,
which
is hard to believe.
It is pretty strange.
Let me bring in Professor Jon Curtice. I mean, there is a contrast here to be made between Westminster, where the books are being opened up, and the regime that already exists in the Scottish Parliament, where you can look at an MSP's taxi chit.
Indeed, of course, there is a very tight regime at Holyrood, indeed a regime that's so tight that it's helped to bring down Scotland's Labour leader, Wendy Alexander. Now, of course, arguably now there are arguments about whether or not Holyrood's rules are in something of a tangle, because, of course, it's felt that whereas on the one hand, Wendy Alexander was given advice that she didn't need to declare some expenses that or some income that she received in pursuit of her election leadership campaign, the Parliament itself eventually received subsequent advice. Now, that's something that sounds that it would need sorting out, but clearly it is a much tighter set of rules.
OK, well, the SNP activist there scrutinising the count in Glasgow East at the Tollcross Leisure Centre. Jon Sopel is still with his panel of politicians elsewhere in the BBC's headquarters here in Glasgow. Over to you, Jon.
Glenn, thank you very much. Yes, I'm enjoying looking at those pictures because it's beginning to look like that count is something of an advanced stage. Now, if you're not used to how these by-elections work, what happens is that when the box is open, there are these people who seem from all the parties who sample what is in the box and they get a very good idea of actually how it's going. And I want to bring in Nicola Sturgeon. I know there has been some active texting and messaging going on and you're hearing what's happening. Are you prepared to call it?
No, not yet, but the news coming from the count is extremely encouraging, or at least extremely encouraging for the SNP. I think it's still fairly close, but it's looking more likely that an SNP win is on the cards. It's certainly looking as if it's going to be a tremendously good night for the SNP, and we are seeing, I think, movement towards the SNP of truly epic proportions. So at this stage of the night, I'm feeling optimistic.
So, let me come to Douglas Alexander and say the corollary of which is, are you saying it's looking like an extremely gloomy night?
At this point in the evening, I'm reminded of the quotation of Congressman Maurice Udall in the United States, who said, "I don't make predictions, least of all about the future." So I think we'll just have to wait a little longer and then we'll get the result.
We heard the discussion there about the whole expenses thing and, you know, what happened to your sister. Do you think she was harshly treated?
I think she was subject to sustained partisan attack by members of Nicola's party. I think that
true,
when it
Douglas.
Comes to a vote in front of the Scottish Parliament, then the fact that there was a highly partisan decision reached by the Standards Committee in the Parliament has the opportunity to be overturned. And while I have the highest regard for my sister, I can't say I feel the same way about some of the members of Nicola's party who chose to, in my view, put partisan interest above the best interests of the Parliament. But the Parliament will have a chance when it comes back in September to make its view clear on the decision that was reached by those individual members of the Standards Committee.
Does that perhaps open the way for your sister to come back if the Parliament takes a different view than the
committee? No, Wendy's made a personal choice in very difficult circumstances. I actually think most people, when looking at the events of recent months, have to ask a fundamental question. Is Scottish politics enhanced or diminished by what we saw taking place on that Standards Committee and the manner of the investigation? Frankly, I think all parliamentarians, this is not simply true of Labour politicians, but all parliamentarians in the Scottish Parliament deserve a better system than a system of inquiry which lasted for many, many months, during which, when you actively seek the advice of the parliamentary clerks, you follow that advice, written advice, and then find that it is subsequently overturned when the Parliamentary Standards Commissioner seeks separate legal advice. I don't think most people, and John Curtis's comments reflected that, think that's a particularly sensible way, but that will be for the Parliament itself to decide.
Nicola Sturgeon, respond to that.
Oh, firstly, I respect Douglas's defence of his sister. It's an incredibly difficult position for somebody to be in when there are family ties, but he's just made a totally disgraceful and despicable slur on a committee of the Scottish Parliament. The Standards Committee was acting on the basis of a report prepared by the Independent Standards Commissioner. That report's now been published, and I think most people, having had the opportunity now to read that report, understand fully why the Standards Committee took the decision that it did.
Decision,
but the second point I would make, Douglas, is that the only reason any of what resulted in Wendy Alexander's resignation came into the public domain in the first place, it was because somebody, not just within the Labour Party, but by definition, because of the nature of the information, it must have been somebody at the heart of her team, leaked that information to the press. So her downfall was down to people within the Labour Party, not to any other party.
Murdo, do you think that she was harshly treated? I detected you nodding your head in agreement with Douglas Alexander.
Yes, I think she was. I think she was harshly treated, and frankly, I think Scottish politics is diminished by the manner of her departure. The Conservative member of the Standards Commission felt that it was right to issue a report saying she had breached the rules. But it was wrong then to go ahead and impose a sanction for the very simple reason that she had sought the advice of committee clerks and had followed the advice she was given. And this advice was then second-guessed by the Standards Commissioner, who is an independent person. And therefore, I think she was harshly treated. And I do think Scottish Parliament has to look at its rules. I don't think Scottish politics is well served when we see senior politicians, and we've seen it in my own party as well, who are hounded out of office over what are, in the great scheme of things, actually very trivial matters over expenses and donations.
Jo Swinson, don't all four of you need to have something of a non-aggression pact over some of the... You know, there are times when it's absolutely clear, crystal clear, when MPs have done wrong and they've, you know, their hand has been in the till or they have behaved inappropriately or whatever it is. But there's often, you kind of look at some of these scandals that blow in and blow out. You think they were nothing very much, and all they did in the end was just increase cynicism about politics in general.
Well, I think what we've got in Holyrood is actually a far superior system, first of all, to Westminster, much more transparency and accountability, and that is a good thing in itself. But I think in a sense that in trying to go to that absolute extreme, it has become quite difficult for politicians if they then get advice to one respect, suddenly then to realise that advice has been wrong, and we do need to sort that situation out. My understanding that with the committee, with this particular case, was that it was to do with the time at which Wendy sought the advice, and that in itself would have been more than the required time that she should have had to declare by if that was the case. So I think it's a little bit more complicated in that case. But in general, I think transparency is a good thing, but we do also need to see the bigger picture and actually recognise, this probably isn't a popular thing to the viewers out there, but politics within Scotland and indeed within the UK is much cleaner than in most other countries. And there is much more scrutiny from the press, which... members of the panel here may not always appreciate, but I think it's actually a good thing. And so we should have a political system that we should be proud of and have some confidence in.
And I want to bring in this side of the room as well in a moment. I just want to ask you, Douglas Alexander, I mean, at Westminster, there was a vote and Labour MPs, Labour cabinet ministers voted to kind of keep things pretty sweet for them. It seemed to the outside incredible.
It was a free vote, the first vote that took place in the House of Commons. It wasn't a whipped vote. I myself have said that had I been in the chamber, I would have voted for the reforms. I was actually in Afghanistan and Pakistan that week. But I have to say, I was in Afghanistan and Pakistan doing my job, presuming the reforms would go through. I was genuinely surprised. And in that sense, I welcomed the opportunity that last week in the House of Commons, there was an opportunity for a further vote on the matter. And I'm glad to say that on that vote, there was a strong consensus in favour of the kind of changes which I agree with Joe are actually necessary at Westminster. So in that sense, I do think that the public are right to say that there needs to be changes. I think that process is now underway and I think it needs to be taken forward.
OK. Fiona, let me come to you about the whole kind of issue of, you know, Wendy Alexander in particular, but the whole issue of expenses and how MPs, MSPs reward themselves or the degree of scrutiny to which they put themselves. I mean, was Wendy Alexander hounded out?
Yes, I think she was, actually, for all the reasons that have already been given. I think, you know, she tried to follow the rules, she did follow the rules, and then she was second-guessed, as I think Murdo said, by somebody else. Anybody looking at that objectively thinks it's crazy. And you have to ask yourself the question, if you're told you have to go and get advice from the clerk to the Standards Committee, he tells you something, that is then wrong, why are you going to talk to him? I mean, what is everybody else meant to do? I think the real problem, there are two problems that arise from this, though. One is huge cynicism on the part of the public who are just turned off and think, oh, they're all at it, you know, they're all trying to make money and they're not interested in us at all. And the other thing, which is equally important, is who in their right mind would stand for public office, you know, as an MP or an MSP? Because you're going to be subjected to people all but, you know, going through your rubbish bin.
Yes, but, I mean, Stephen Purcell, we were hearing from Michael Crick a little while ago about, you know, the questions that surrounded sort of David Marshall and the expenses. And that doesn't that just feed into the cynicism that, you know, Labour have been the ruling class for so long in Scotland, they take a lot of things for granted, that maybe corners have been cut and they've been more interested in feathering their own nests than looking after the people they were elected to represent?
Well, can I tell you that was not an issue on the doorsteps in the East End of Glasgow, and whatever the result tonight, this is not a constituency that has been failed by Labour, either in terms of the way in which the constituency has changed and the fortune of the people has got better, whilst we've still a long way to go, or indeed by the way in which people who have represented them from the Labour Party in Glasgow have behaved. So I don't recognise that picture that you paint, but what I do recognise is that there's a growing cynicism about politicians and about whether we use public money in the wisest way. So I think it's right that there's a debate about reform, and that we all have a responsibility, whether in local or national government, to be aware that perception is as important as reality. And sometimes maybe that's not something politicians are always good at.
Yes, Jerry, I wonder what your view on that is.
Yeah, I mean, I think the criminology of the Scottish Labour Party is a subject that fascinates many of us, and it's difficult even here to get into it, let alone from outside. And basically, one of the failures of Wendy Alexander was Wendy Alexander, like Gordon Brown, stood and deliberately stopped there being a proper leadership contest. And she then raises £17,000 for money for when there's not going to be a leadership contest. So you end up with her being the fourth Labour leader in Scotland who's elected, anointed, without a Labour leadership contest. I mean, it's taken the Scottish Labour Party 9 years of devolution to have a contest. I mean, that's frankly tells you something about the soul of the Scottish Labour Party. Democracy is this kind of alien subject to it. And two of those four leaders have fallen in things about financial skullduggery, Henry McLeish and Wendy Alexander. And that isn't an accident either. The boundaries between the local state and the kind of clientism of Scottish Labour have kind of got into this awful mess. And people like Douglas have to recognise that. It's not good, Douglas. Democracy is this kind of alien subject to the party.
Murray, I promise you I'll bring you in a minute on this, but I think you've asked the question.
I'm almost speechless as to where to start, John. You started the conversation about Wendy by saying it was about expenses. Actually, the issue was about a donation to the campaign. It was nothing to do with Wendy's expenses. Secondly, Jerry's views on the Scottish Labour Party are well known and well recorded north of the border. The idea Wendy forced anybody out of the leadership of the Scottish Labour Party is nonsense. If you stand in an election, it's not for you to force other people to stand, it's for other candidates to come forward. And in that sense, when you throw around charges like skullduggery and the soul of the Scottish Labour Party, I actually think you do a disservice to what's an important and serious debate. What kind of politics do we want in Scotland? I first met Nicola 12 years ago, 13 years ago, campaigning in a by-election when she was working alongside Rosanna Cunningham. I actually now watch Nicola and Rosanna acting as Alex attack dogs against Wendy, and I just think we can do better than this in Scotland. We shouldn't have a politics.
Attacked Wendy Douglas.
We shouldn't have a politics of personal destruction.
Well, I think you should retract that
without
statement
being
because
disagreeable.
I made no comment about Wendy Alexander before her resignation.
The real battle is actually about who has a better vision for Scotland.
Nicola Sturgeon makes the point that she never attacked
Wendy Alexander before her resignation. So, you know, if you want to deprecate others for the politics of personal attack,
so you and Rosanna never,
you should,
never went for Wendy
I'm
over the issue
for
of
myself.
The donations.
I did not go for Wendy, as you put it, over the issue of donations. I commented after her resignation. So,
you made no public comment on Wendy before her resignation?
Douglas, if you don't want
Nicola,
these kind of comments...
You said nothing about Wendy before the issue of her resignation.
You're making accusations about me that I am certainly saying are not true.
Right,
now,
okay.
you really should practice
true,
what you preach. If you want to talk down
I'm going
the politics
I'm going
of personal
to
destruction,
you because
don't
we should. I'm going to let me interrupt you there because I don't think we're going to get agreement on that one either, and I think we've kind of exhausted that. But you can see there Margaret Curran arriving at the count, being greeted by her supporters. A lot of people said she ran a very, very good campaign. But it appears from what we are hearing inside, where she has just arrived, where she's walking into now, that it looks like the SNP may well have won Glasgow East, Labour's third safest seat in Scotland. She is now inside the hall. We wait to see John Mason because it looks like he is going to be the victorious candidate. But of course, that's still to be confirmed. They have been counting now for 2 hours and 32 minutes. The polling stations closed 2 hours, 33 minutes ago. I correct myself by looking at the clock. Glenn.
Thanks very much indeed, John. And we can cross live to the count now and talk with David Cairns, the Scotland Office Minister, who's been a key figure in this Labour campaign. And Margaret Curran, your candidate, has just arrived in the hall. But is she arriving to celebrate victory, or will she be commiserated in defeat.
Well, they're still counting the votes, Glenn. They may have been counting for 2.5 hours, but as far as I'm aware, they haven't finished yet. It's obviously very close, but I'm going to do the people the honour of waiting until the results actually been announced before speculating on that.
Talk from the nationalist camp of a majority in their favour of 1,000 votes. Is that a conceivable result from what you have been able to pick up?
Well, I'm actually absolutely rubbish at sampling. I've had a go at it and I never really know what I'm doing, so I leave that to the professionals. But I said on Monday, Glenn, that I thought this was going to be tight and I thought it was going to be close. People raised their eyebrows and said that this was some sort of spin or expectation management. And I didn't believe that. I genuinely absolutely thought it would be tight and it would be close. I remember Hamilton South, where we had a 16,000 majority that almost evaporated, and we had Falkirk West and a 13,500 that almost evaporated. And that was at the very high watermark of the Tony Blair honeymoon before we went on to win a landslide victory in 2001. So even in good political times, you can get an enormous upset in a by-election. I think most people recognise that now we're midway through a third term, when the national polls aren't as favourable, and when people are feeling the pinch with rising food prices and petrol prices and so on, that this was always going to be an extremely difficult by-election to win, and that looks as though that may be the case.
Margaret Curran being welcomed by supporters at the count. She's in the middle of that crowd that you can see in your screen now, surrounded by MPs, at least one MSP, journalists and many others. Obviously, a lot of people keen to talk to her tonight as we await the result in this by-election. But as you say, David Cairns, people in by-elections can turn out to punish the government. Why would they do that in this campaign at this time?
Well, for the reasons I mentioned earlier, there are real pressures on people's budgets, with food prices, with utility bills, with petrol prices. And people have been bringing that up to us on the doorstep every single day. People are feeling the pinch, and they know that there's a global issue. They know that the issues like the credit crunch aren't just affecting us, but we're the government and we're the ones that people look to blame for the problems and to sort them out. So I think it's incumbent, if the result is as you're predicting it, Glenn, I think it's incumbent on all of us in government, every one of us, to consider the message that people are sending this evening, to come forward, explain what we're doing better, and address the real concerns that people have raised with us.
Well, I can tell you I'm not daft enough to make a prediction this close to the result, simply reporting what we've been hearing so far tonight. Just before you go, though, I mean, all this talk about defeat for Labour having a knock-on effect and perhaps signalling the beginning of the end for Gordon Brown, do you subscribe to that theory?
Now, I said in the very first interview I gave at the start of this campaign, and I've said it in every other interview I've given ever since, that the fate of Prime Ministers don't turn on individual by-elections. I thought that irrespective of what the result tonight would be, that Gordon Brown would be the leader of the Labour Party into the next election and will lead us to victory at that election.
OK, perhaps we'll talk later when we have a result. David Cairns, the Scotland Office Minister at the count in the East End, and Michael Crick. You've been following the campaign very closely. You're normally based in London. You'll pick up all the gossip and the rumour. If this goes the SNP's way and Labour's defeated, what do you think the union leaders, Gordon Brown's meeting tomorrow, will have to say?
Well, clearly it's going to be an interesting weekend at Warwick University, the National Policy Forum. People were saying at the beginning of the campaign, some commentators were saying, if Labour loses this seat, then that's curtains for Gordon Brown. I never subscribed to that view. I think it will obviously strengthen, to some extent, the union leaders' hand this weekend, but there's going to be quite a tussle taking place at Warwick over the extent to which they're allowed to influence the policy platform, which forms the basis of the next manifesto. But it will inevitably, those MPs who were expressing their dissatisfaction with Brown after the local elections and the Crewe and Nantwich result, will be no doubt repeating those points, and it'll be interesting to see whether others join them. But it's the summer. A lot of people are going to be away on their holidays. Parliament's not sitting. In those circumstances, there may not be the kind of rumblings that one would see
Yeah, that's just Margaret Curran at the count there. She's right in the centre of frame in the red jacket. Red, of course, for Labour with the blonde hair. And a hug and perhaps a kiss too for a supporter there at the Glasgow count. Although the signs, as we've been reporting, perhaps not going Labour's way tonight in Glasgow East. That would be bad news for Margaret Curran personally, obviously, having taken on this challenge, but it would pretty much rule out her earlier hopes of making a pitch for the leadership of the Labour Party in the Scottish Parliament, where she's a senior figure.
Well, I guess certainly probably make that rather more difficult, given, as it were, she fought this fight and apparently would have seemed to have failed to do it. I mean, I think in truth, having said that, however, I mean, however this does turn out tonight, I think one has to say Margaret Curran certainly tried to make the best of what was undoubtedly a pretty bad job. She did fight, I think, what many people have regarded as an effective campaign. Effectively, she tried to make this a campaign about herself and about her personal advocacy for the East End and tried to deflect it away from Westminster.
What about this lot then? This is the SNP activists outside the count in the darkness with plenty of balloons and good cheer by the looks of things, Michael Crick.
Yes, they've been, there were hundreds of them out on the streets today. It was extraordinary, the numbers there, a lot more than there were Labour activists. At the polling stations I went round, nearly everyone had an SNP person there, in some cases more than one, whereas there were most of them didn't have a Labour person standing there.
But that's quite extraordinary for the Scottish scene, because the SNP traditionally has been dwarfed by the Labour Party machine, but perhaps not in this case?
No, I think that's been true throughout the campaign, that the SNP have had the numbers there out on the streets. And it was like a party atmosphere outside their headquarters this evening. It was almost as if they had more workers than they knew what to do with. It has been a well-run campaign, reminding me of many of the Liberal Democrat campaigns that traditionally have seen them winning by-elections, sometimes in Scotland, but more often in England in the past.
Are we talking about a Rolls-Royce campaign against a penny farthing or not?
Well,
quite
I mean, the SNP had the numbers, but I think actually Labour's campaign was a pretty good campaign overall, apart from the early problems they had in selecting a candidate. Once Margaret Curran was in place, I think they deflected they managed to avoid the David Marshall issue until the very end. They managed to concentrate on Margaret Curran as an individual. She was all over their literature. I mean, there's one leaflet, I think you've got it there.
Oh, yes.
Where she's pictured 15 times. No, not that one, but another one. Where she's pictured 15 times. So I think Labour ran it pretty well, given the circumstances they had. And Margaret Curran, it's clear to me, is pretty popular, despite the result we're expecting, was pretty popular with quite a lot of the people in her Scottish parliamentary constituency.
Worth mentioning that she is a member of the Scottish Parliament for the Baileston constituency, which is entirely contained within Glasgow East, the Westminster seat. But, John Curtice, what a mess at the start. Labour struggling to find a candidate to get somebody to stand in what should be a rock-solid Labour seat. And in the end, was she, what, fifth choice candidate?
Indeed. Well, there was a mess at the beginning. But I think perhaps there's a bigger question to the Labour Party to ask itself about this by-election. That is, why did it go head rush into it? It had already discovered in Curran and Wich that running a by-election campaign quickly was not necessarily going to stop it suffering a big swing. And perhaps we're now about to see that lesson repeated in this Glasgow by-election. Now, why a government that is in deep electoral trouble in the polls wants to run a by-election
now,
quickly?
Here is John Curtice, another John. John Mason, the SNP candidate, being welcomed to the count, first of all, by Angus Robertson, the MP. We spoke to him a little earlier. And obviously the SNP's foot soldiers, complete with their soul tires. And it's starting to look like, perhaps prematurely, a victory celebration, I think.
It is. I mean, the mood when I was at the count, what must be an hour ago, I think that most people then thought the SNP were going to win. And you can see from their faces that they know that even if they weren't to win tonight, that they've made a big impact here in this constituency just by running Labour so close.
Now they have, what, half a dozen MPs at Westminster, a tiny proportion, but do you think as a Westminster watcher that they tend to punch above their weight? Would one more make much of a difference?
I'm not sure, actually. It would make a huge amount of difference at Westminster. I mean, frankly, a lot of the time, then that their full contingent isn't there anyway. The impact is on politics in general, the fact that they have won a by-election. And actually, over the years, the SNP doesn't win by-elections as often as sometimes we think they do. And they have, embarrassed Labour in a very big way and embarrassed the Prime Minister in a big way.
In fact, it's been, 20 years since the SNP won a by-election against Labour in, obviously in Scotland, John Curtice.
Yeah, I mean, there are two famous by-election victories in recent years for the SNP from Labour, both in Glasgow government.
Hang on, these pictures are extraordinary. This man is waiting to hear the result, but already he's being cheered at the count. He's performing a victory dance by the looks of things.
Well, indeed. I mean, so far the SNP have been very careful not to claim victory, but those pictures, as it were, tell 1,000 words. And those are pictures that do not make any attempt at all to try and hide the fact that the SNP think that they've won this by-election.
Interesting.
That's an MSP for Glasgow, for the whole city of Glasgow that he was being greeted by there as he makes his way further into the count.
Well, one of the interesting aspects of John Mason's campaign is, this is one of the first times we've actually seen John Mason in public without Alex Salmond being there. I mean, perhaps Mr. Salmond will turn up later, but he was certainly out on the streets tonight getting the vote out in the constituency. Alex Salmond's made 11, 12 visits to the constituency, and every time one went out to film John Mason, Mr. Salmond was at his side.
But he's been very carefully shepherded by Angus Robinson, who is, of course, the leader of the SNP at Westminster. Yes.
OK, well, we haven't heard from the leader of the SNP, Alex Salmond, yet, but, of course, John has Nicola Sturgeon, deputy leader, deputy first minister with him. John.
Thank you very much indeed, Glenn. Yes, Nicola Sturgeon, what do you think, looking at those pictures?
I was just thoroughly enjoying watching those pictures.
So, hang on. You're still saying that you haven't won where you've got your candidate doing this?
Well, whatever happens tonight, John Mason has scored an absolutely fantastic result in this by-election. And can I pay tribute to him and say that he has been an outstanding candidate? And Labour have tried to be very personally negative about John Mason over the last couple of weeks. They've been quite sneering about him, tried to belittle him. He's been an outstanding candidate and he's scored an amazing result here tonight, and all credit to him.
A bit of a celebration in the Sturgeon household tonight? Because wasn't your partner somewhat involved?
My partner's the chief executive of the SNP. If you look closely, you can occasionally see him around there. So. But he's looking a bit deadpan at the moment, so he's given nothing away.
Oh, he's giving nothing away. Your partner's giving nothing away. John Mason is the picture of calm sang-froid.
Well, what can you say?
Let's get this on the record. You've won.
I don't know the result yet. It's looking more and more likely that the SNP have scored a victory here tonight, but whatever the result, it is a tremendous, tremendous swing towards the SNP. And I think we should all congratulate John Mason and let him enjoy his moment.
Yeah, and I'm sure that everyone would be gracious enough around this table to say that, congratulations to the victor. Although it's slightly odd, isn't it, to walk in with your arms aloft when we haven't heard from the returning officer?
He has scored a tremendous swing towards the SNP. None of us know the result yet, but whatever that result is, he has done tremendously well, and I think he's quite entitled to have behaved in that way, and he's quite entitled to feel very, very proud of himself because he's been a first-class candidate, and I hope very much indeed that he's about to go on to become a first-class MP for the East End of Glasgow because they really need it.
There's always a debate in politics over whether it is because of the positive policies that someone has put forward or that you're voting against, what has been.
It's an interesting point because let's reflect on the fact that this will be the first by-election in history that has been a contest between two governments. It's been a contest between the government in London and the government in Holyrood. That's never ever happened before, and I think what we're seeing tonight is that it's been a massive vote of confidence in the SNP government in Holyrood and more than a bit of a disappointment for the government in London.
Would you be gracious enough to accept, though, that when you've been the government for just a year, defying political gravity is easier than when you've been in office
for over 10 years.
Yeah, people, commentators keep sort of asking themselves how long the SNP government honeymoon is going to last. I don't think the SNP government is in a honeymoon any longer. What we are doing is performing well as a government. And what was very clear in the doorsteps of Glasgow East was that while there is deep frustration that Gordon Brown's government is doing next to nothing to help people with the current economic circumstances, what we have in Edinburgh is an SNP government that has frozen council tax, cut prescription charges, cut business rates, trying to help people in tough economic climate. And that, I think, is what we're seeing reflected in the result in Glasgow East tonight.
In terms of Westminster politics and Parliament, what difference does it make?
Alex Salmond predicted an earthquake a couple of weeks ago, and you know, some commentators thought he was a bit premature in doing that. If we are about to see the result that everybody is beginning to think we might be about to see here, then we've had an earthquake that is absolutely off the Richter scale in terms of its significance. And we know from by-election wins for the SNP in the past, whether that was Hamilton in 1967, the two Govan by-election victories, that they do change the course of Scottish politics. And you know, I think most people in Scotland would struggle to name most Labour MPs because they are completely faceless and most of the time voiceless. Every single MP for the SNP at Westminster fights Scotland's corner, and I really, really hope we're about to send another one down there to make sure that the voice of Scotland and the East End of Glasgow is heard loudly and clearly.
Well, as you look at the face of John Mason, and it's a face that I'm sure will be on a number of front pages tomorrow, though he might have to compete a little bit with another politician called Barack Obama, who had a minor day in Berlin today. But John Mason certainly enjoying his moment in the political sunshine. It looks set that he is to be the new Member of Parliament for Glasgow East. We're still waiting on the declaration. The polling stations closed nearly 3 hours ago. The latest I'm hearing in my ear is that perhaps we'll get a result in 10 minutes' time, but I've done too many by-elections to take 10 minutes too seriously because, frankly, there's always that bit of delay. They have to call all the party agents together. They have to get everyone assembled. And, you know, and if someone starts quibbling over a few ballots here and there, that can obviously delay things. Douglas Alexander, I've tried to tempt you on a number of occasions this evening and so far utterly failed to say whether it's going to be a good or a bad night. Those pictures do seem to speak for themselves.
They do, although I have to say I think we've also seen something historic this evening, which is probably the first and last ever comparison of Joan Mason and Barack Obama. He doesn't look like a man. He doesn't look like a man who's lost. Clearly there's a degree of artifice until we get the results, so we'll have to wait and see what happens.
Jo Swinson, let me come to you, because I've covered so many by-elections where, you know, the Liberal Democrats have done staggeringly well, have come in all sorts of improbable constituencies and have managed to get ahead of steam game. And the Liberal Democrats don't seem to be going anywhere particularly at the moment. Isn't that a fair comment on if you look at what happened? I'll go through a few. London mayoral elections, how did that go?
That wasn't a fantastic result for us, but that was also,
let's face it,
the London mayoral election was also between two very huge personalities in Boris and Ken. Curran Nanwich, we were in third place to start with, and you had the Conservatives on a roll. I think when you look at some of our by-election gains, such as Brent East, for example, and one of the reasons why Labour have been so keen to go for the short by-election, Brent East, there was about 3 months of campaigning. Glasgow, we were starting from a standing start. But what we've had within the course of this Parliament, the looks like, if we get the result we're expecting tonight, that this will be an SNP gain, so that Labour will have lost three by-elections, one to the Conservatives, one to the Liberal Democrats and one to the SNP. I think it's clear that people are looking for an alternative to the Labour government and keen to punish the government for what they see as its mismanagement of the economy and not listening to the concerns of voters on the streets.
Murdo, are you prepared to call it that you've got third place?
It's looking good. I was just reflecting that John Mason's going to look pretty daft in half an hour if he hasn't won. But the feedback we're getting is that I think he has won. That's the feedback I've had. It's looking quite good for us for third place, I think. That'll be good. I mean, I think the Liberal Democrats actually have had a pretty rough night. They've not done well in recent elections. And really, in Scotland at the moment, they're a party without a leader. They're a party really without a sense of direction. And I think Scottish politics increasingly is becoming a three-horse race between Labour, SNP and the Conservatives. And I think you've got to remember, there's a whole clutch of Labour seats in Scotland where the Conservatives are the challengers, not the SNP. I think what we're seeing tonight is a situation where in what is a very safe Labour seat, people are coalescing around the person best placed to defeat the incumbent. And I think that's good news for the Conservatives in Scotland, as well as for the SNP.
Douglas Alexander, we've talked about a lot about this by-election tonight. I just wonder whether you wished you had gone ahead with that general election last autumn.
I was charged with making preparations to allow the Prime Minister to reach a decision. I've never talked publicly about the advice that I offered the Prime Minister, both previous to that decision or after that decision, and I'm not planning to change that practice this evening.
But you don't think it would have been a good idea to have had that election? When you see things now, I mean, I'm not asking you for the private advice you gave Gordon Brown, that's fine, but I'm just asking you whether you think Labour would have been better placed to have gone for that election.
I can tell you what I told you to somebody who asked a similar question the week afterwards, which was to say I believed that we could have won a general election last autumn, and I believe we can and we will win the next general election. We've got a lot of work to do, we're not complacent, not least given the kind of result we're anticipating this evening, we've got a lot of work to do. But on the other hand, I do believe that if you see the broader picture in terms of the challenges the country faces, then Labour actually do have better solutions than the other parties.
I just wonder whether you think that we've talked a lot this evening about a wide range of issues, and you've talked about the economic downturn and the difficulties you're facing. You'd have been miles better off going last autumn.
Well, that presumes that if there's an economic downturn, people don't judge Labour better able to manage the challenge of that economic downturn than the other parties. And frankly, there's been a lot of publicity in the course of this campaign about sending a message. One of the reasons that I think the parties have been keen to say send a message to Labour is there have been so few practical alternatives offered to the challenges of food or fuel or how to deal with a mortgage.
I just wonder whether I can ask the rest of the panel whether they think that it was, I know you all wear partisan hats, but whether Labour should have gone for that election last October. I mean, Murdo, I'm interested in whether you think that
Gordon Brown bottled it. He had the opportunity to call an election at that particular time. People apparently were advising him to do so. I think he must now have sleepless nights looking back on that situation, wishing he had called an election, because it's all been downhill ever since then. I don't know what the outcome of that election would have been had he called it then, but things were looking a lot better for him at that time than they are now, and it's really difficult to see any way back for him out of the hole he's dug himself and the Labour Party into.
Jo Swinson.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I think obviously he should have gone with it. I mean, I can't see things getting better for Labour now. What I think, though, is there's some sort of great sort of air of tragedy about this. I mean, this is a man who wanted the top job for something like 20 years and was there in the background making his preparations and then finally got it to such great expectation. And apart from the first few months where he seemed to be doing well, actually, it seems that now people have just sort of decided, well, no, actually, we don't like him very much, and it's all just turned to dust. And while, I'm no great supporter of the Labour Party, I think on a personal level for Gordon Brown, it certainly does seem a bit sad.
And Nicola Sturgeon, we're sitting here looking at Margaret Curran, and there are people sort of smiling and patting, keeping their spirits up. Do you think that it was a mistake not to have called that election?
Of course it was. I mean, he made a number of mistakes. The first mistake was allowing speculation to build to fever pitch about the election. The second mistake was having done so to call the election off. That was a monumental mistake. But the third mistake, and I think the one that probably lost him most respect, was denying that his decision to call the election off was anything to do with the sudden shift in opinion polls and was because he was scared of losing it. And I think Gordon Brown, during that whole episode, just lost so much respect. And in all of that, really allowed this perception, and indeed, I think, reality of him as a ditherer to grow and take root.
Douglas Alexander, was it a tipping point?
I can honestly tell you, on all the doors that I've knocked on in Easter House, in Baileson, in Glasgow East over the last 3 weeks, not a single voter has mentioned the decision whether to have an election or not last autumn. I think if you compare what I fully accept was an issue that dominated political coverage with the issues that we've been talking about this evening, it actually is much more, as has been suggested this evening, the general issues of the economy which account for the challenges that we face, rather than decisions or non-decisions that were reached many months ago.
Do you not accept that there are those of your colleagues, maybe not in the government publicly, but some privately, who believe that Gordon Brown's leadership is an issue? They may be misguided, but don't you accept that there are those Labour MPs who are thinking now, goodness, how on earth are we going to win an election with Gordon Brown?
Well, within any political party, there is going to be divergent views. I mentioned Rosanna earlier. I mean, I don't think Rosanna and Alec are best buddies within the SNP. The truth is, in any political party, you're going to have a combination of people who may have personally frustrated ambition, may have a different vision of where the party should go. But in that sense, I think there is a strong sense that we're in this together within the Labour Party, because actually we do face significant challenges. And the real challenge is not actually for the Labour Party, it's to deliver for people in Glasgow East, in Paisley, in constituencies right across the country. And that's what I hope and believe when we take place, we take part in the National Policy Forum tomorrow, will actually be the dominating issue, which is not simply how do we get ourselves from where we are now, but actually how do we deliver for the people who elected us and earn the trust to get a fourth term.
But it becomes increasingly difficult. I mean, you look at the National Policy Forum and you look at sort of some of the, you know, list shopping demands that the unions are placing. I mean, what are you going to do about those sort of things?
Well, what we're going to do tomorrow is to discuss with both members of constituency parties and the trade unions what should be the manifesto for the fourth term of a Labour government. That's the same approach that we took to devising the last manifesto, and it's the basis on which I believe we can actually pull together the policies that will help us win that victory.
Do you think this changes anything, this by-election?
Oh, I'm respectful of whatever decision is reached in a by-election, and I would be the last person, having been elected to Parliament myself in a by-election, to suggest that by-elections don't matter. They do matter. They matter because it will decide who's going to represent the people of Glasgow East in Parliament. That being said, no by-election is irretrievable. You mentioned the by-election 20 years ago when the SNP won. They subsequently lost that seat at the next general election, and that's been a pattern not just with the SNP but the Liberal Democrats. That can't be certain. Of course, we would have to work hard if we don't win this evening to win back the seat, but I can give you an assurance on behalf of the Labour Party, there will be a determination, whatever the result this evening, to make sure that at the next general election, we return a Labour MP for Glasgow East.
Nicola Sturgeon, you've got your phone there. You were caught. I hope you were caught.
Sorry, I was caught on camera there taking a text message.
Yeah. So, telling
you, would you believe me if I said
it? I told you it was
too close to call.
Whether we had 2 pints of milk tomorrow, or have you forgotten to remember to cancel the newspapers? No, I don't believe that. Come on.
It was actually a text from a friend who's on holiday in Lanzarote asking me what the result of the by-election
is. In Lanzarote, it must be very late at night. Anyway, well, I'm glad that people are in Lanzarote are watching us. I'm sure they could watch us on the web somehow and kind of keep up to date with it. Well, it's now 1 o'clock in the morning. If you've just joined us, it has been. We've been waiting now for quite some time. We're hoping that the result will be any time soon. I just wonder whether I can talk to some of our other panellists over the other side of the room who have been waiting very patiently. And Murray Ritchie, let me come to you, because I was going to talk to you a short time ago, and I'm sure our cameras are now busily trying to get round to find you. I mean, this particular... Does this by-election matter?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. This is... I can't remember a by-election like this ever. I mean, God help me, I can go back to the 60s and Winnie Ewing at Hamilton, and the two governed by elections, and this outranks all of them, for the simple reason that
Tell me why it outranks them.
Well, as Nicola said earlier, the SNP are in government. This has never happened before, where they've won a by election in government. Not only that, they're ahead in the opinion polls in Scotland, which has never happened, but it has happened very briefly in the past. But they've got a sustained lead in the opinion polls just now while they're in government. And now they're winning. This is a phenomenal result, if it turns out to be indeed an SNP victory. The idea that they can take away the safest Labour seat in Scotland and one of the safest in the UK has implications for the whole of the United Kingdom. Because out of this will come more momentum towards constitutional change, possibly independence, eventually for Scotland. And that has implications for the whole of the UK. So if the SNP have truly done this tonight, it is a phenomenal result for the SNP and a catastrophe for Labour.
Fiona, do you share that view?
Yeah, I think Murray has got a point. The thing is, yes, it's a very dramatic result at the time. I'm not entirely sure what the long-term implications are, though. There are actually very few by-elections that have actually changed the course of history. They seem very dramatic at the time, but 2 or 3 years later on, well, either the MP who won the seat has then disappeared and the original party has taken it over, or even worse, people have forgotten their name.
Sure, I suspect what you're talking about is the thunderclaps that you hear immediately after a by-election result. I wonder whether what they can have an effect on is who remains the leader of a political party and things like that.
Sorry, we're back to Gordon Brown again.
Yeah.
Well, the other thing you've got to factor in there, if there's a group of people who decide they're going to go and take out Gordon Brown within the Labour Party because they're worried about their own seats, think that through. That would be the third Prime Minister that we had in just over a year. Now, the demand for a general election at that point would be enormous. I mean, you could not have three prime ministers in just over a year, arguably two of whom didn't really have a mandate. So how many of these backbenchers who really worried about their seats are going to risk that? Not many.
Well, yeah, but you say that. I mean, I kind of watched the demise of Thatcher and then the attempt to get John Major. I mean, isn't often the reaction to panic first and think later?
Up to a point, but in neither of those cases did they go for an immediate general election. The circumstances were different. I mean, we've had a sitting prime minister replaced before during the term of a parliament. That's not unusual. We haven't done it three times, though. And I think there would be such a public outcry. I mean, I'm not sure it would be democratically credible to continue without a general election.
Yes. Stephen, what do you think the consequences are if, as we're hearing, it is an SNP victory?
Well, you know, I think it's always important to remind ourselves that this process has started, this debate rather started, because of how people have voted in a by-election. And inevitably, all of us that are so interested in politics get caught up in all of the hype and the drama and the future of the government or the future of the Prime Minister, as we've debated earlier. Now, what's happened today is that we've had a very interesting turnout. It's a turnout that was higher than was reached at the Scottish Parliament election in this constituency last year. So we've had a fair test of opinion. And whilst I'm clear that the biggest issue for me on the doorstep with voters was about the economy, I mean, I think there are wider issues that we in the Labour Party have to think about. And I think that debate will begin at the National Policy Forum in Warwick.
Can I just tell you what? We went to a polling station in Shettleston and the Labour activist who was handing out leaflets and encouraging people to vote for Margaret Curran said to me, "I hope we win, but I really hope we only just win because the party needs to learn a lesson."
Yeah, I mean, I think there's lessons we have to learn around our message, about our communication, about our presentation. We have to remind ourselves that when we first won in 1997, we had a very powerful way of delivering that message. But more important than the message is about what the message is. And I think we have to look at a much more radical approach to our policy agenda that we're following, that yes, understands at the heart of people's concerns is the economy, but you know, in the earliest years of this Labour government, we were radical and we were positive, and I think we need to have a debate about what the next decade of Labour is about. And there's another dimension, of course, here in Scotland, and that is the fact.
And we're looking at some of those Labour activists who are probably going to be sort of central to that debate, or will want to play their part in that debate. But I'm going to try and strip away some of the code of what you're saying. You seem to be saying to me, Gordon Brown, good man, but he hasn't articulated a clear vision of what a Brown premiership is about.
Well, I think it's about the whole party. It's not about one.
Well, there's one guy who's leading it.
It's not about one person. I'm absolutely clear he is the right person. Let's remember something. Gordon Brown was chosen by the Labour Party just over a year ago. He was the unanimous choice of the Labour Party. And I think it would be wrong for us to react on the basis of one by-election about the leader of the party. But I think what we have to do is listen to the people who have voted. And I've spoken to literally hundreds of people, and I think we need to articulate something that to them that tells them what not just about what our way forward in terms of the economic pressures are, but how we are going to get them through it. And it has to be a message based on optimism and hope and positive, and we have to be radical.
Gerry Hassan, what does this by-election tell us, and maybe what does it tell us, if anything, about the people of Scotland's desire for independence?
Well, I don't know.
Which is something we haven't really talked about, and yet
I don't know if it actually tells us much about that. What you have to see in the context of, there's one myth that needs to be explored, is the SNP have not actually been historically that good at winning by-elections. They've won five Westminster by-elections out of 71 till this day. But all five of those by-elections have been really important from Motherwell onwards. And you have to put it in the context of this long war of attrition between Labour and the SNP in the Central Belt. And basically, I mean, speaking to SNP canvassers, they said when they used to go around the doorsteps 30 years ago in places like Garscadden, they were met with invective
and abuse by voters. That's no longer the case. They said things like the Labour local council wouldn't give them things like committee rooms. That doesn't happen now. The playing field between Labour and SNP is changing in the west of Scotland. And Labour's thrown practically everything at the seat, and it looks like it's not been able to hold it. So I think the plates, so to speak, are shifting in the west of Scotland slowly. And this by-election is just one small part of that. It doesn't break the plates, basically, of Labour's hold on Scotland, or west of Scotland.
All of you, for the moment, thank you very much. I said 20 minutes ago the result would be in 10 minutes. I'm not going to go into the political prediction business. Glenn, any further idea when we might get a result?
Let's find out and talk to Aileen Clarke, who's at the count. It certainly hasn't happened at 1 o'clock. What's the latest best guess?
Well, what we are expecting and what we're being told is that we'll get the result somewhere between 20 past one and half past one. Now, you can see that people have already taken their seats in expectation of that. Over the other side of the hall, they're looking at the spoiled ballot papers, but as I understand it, the main vote has now been counted. So, really, we are now minutes from getting this result. Now, with the huge cheer that went up from the SNP when Councillor Mason arrived here tonight, it would be a big shock now if the SNP were not declared winners here. Of course, what's going to be interesting then is what the margin is. Now, various estimates around this hall. One of them I've heard recently could be that the margin may be a majority of somewhere in the region of 1,400 to 1,500 votes. That's the best I can give you at the moment. We're not really going to know until they take the stage. But obviously, there is a bit of a chat about, you know, how close it's going to be. Might there be a recount? Certainly, we're hearing nothing so far to indicate that a recount is in the offing. So perhaps that margin of votes may be a reasonable guess.
I guess this has been throughout a two-horse race, and the others, some of them have even conceded that they were playing for third place. Who do you think is in line to take that slot?
Well, the Conservatives are still very confident that they are going to take third place, and the Liberal Democrats have more or less conceded that, yep, they're going to be in fourth place. In fact, I understand the Liberal Democrats are also quite worried about whether or not they're actually going to save their deposit. Very much so, it seems to have been that this was, as you say, Glenn, a two-horse race, and the smaller parties got squeezed. The Green Party say they've got absolutely no chance of saving their deposit. You know, it wasn't that kind of a by-election. It was SNP or Labour all the way, really, as far as the voters were concerned. And what's going to be quite interesting is it seems to be the chat in the hall here is that, in effect, the SNP got their voters out and Labour just didn't. Now, of course, we know that the SNP party machine, when it cranks up and gets going, can be fairly awesome. It seems they did manage to pull that off. It seems what I'm hearing is that in the places where they thought they would do well, they did more than well. And at the same time, the places Labour should have done well and in the pockets of the constituency that should have been really, really good for them, well, they just didn't get their voters out. So much soul searching now amongst the Labour Party. And, you know, already people are starting to say, where did this all go wrong? Because even a few days ago, they thought that they'd done enough.
And if it turns out that they have not done enough, obviously a huge celebration for the SNP there, and the Labour Party will be licking its wounds. But you mentioned some of the smaller parties, Aileen. In fact, five candidates beyond those standing for the four main parties. Any indications as to how they might finish up in this contest?
Well, badly. I mean, effectively. I mean, the vote has just not been there for them. I mean, I was talking
so if
to
the Greens
Tommy
don't keep their deposit, then the others won't either?
Well, I don't think so. I mean, if the Liberal Democrats aren't going to keep their deposit, I think it's hardly likely that any of the rest of them will. Tommy Sheridan earlier was saying he was fairly confident that Solidarity would come out on top as the best, if you like, of the smaller parties. But I think, you know, there is some despondency amongst the smaller parties tonight that, in effect, they really were kind of squeezed out. This wasn't going to be their by-election in a way. So a bit of licking of their wounds as well. But certainly, they put it down fairly and squarely to this turning into a two-horse race. So I don't think there's an awful lot of soul-searching amongst them. They were just really a victim of circumstances. This has turned out to be quite a special by-election.
OK, well, let us know as soon as a declaration is imminent. Thanks for the moment, Aileen. Professor John Curtice, a lot of tactical voting, do you think, been going on in Glasgow East to give Labour a bloody nose?
Well, certainly if the Liberal Democrats have indeed lost their deposit, then one possibility is that voters who might otherwise vote for the Liberal Democrats switch to the SNP. Though we should bear in mind this is usually pretty poor territory for the Liberal Democrats. Their vote in 2005 was unusually high because, again, we tend to forget this. The Liberal Democrats did very well in Scotland in 2005. They actually beat us, the SNP, across Scotland in general. I think the other thing we can say is if Aileen's estimate of the majority is right, we're probably looking at a swing at around 24-25%, which will be the third highest swing to the SNP ever, but not as big as in the two government by-elections.
Well, that's probably not something Margaret Curran's going to want to put in her CV, and she doesn't look too cheerful about her prospects, although there she is, turning up a smile just when I say that. She, it's worth pointing out, won't lose out too much in terms of this by-election, because she is already an elected member of the Scottish Parliament, although, as we were saying earlier, perhaps her prospects of standing in the leadership race for the Labour leadership at Holyrood might be dented somewhat. Just in terms of the third place, Michael Crick, if that goes to the Conservatives rather than the Liberal Democrats, why do you think that would be? Is it suddenly there is a Cameron effect in Scotland?
Well, certainly I think it's been a good campaign for the Conservatives. They had an interesting candidate, a black woman who's also an active trade unionist.
And they've, not typical Tory.
Not a typical Conservative. And they've run their campaign with a certain gusto and sort of, you know, good humour. And they've had a lot of their stars up here. David Cameron at the very beginning making an interesting speech on how people need to be more responsible when it comes to issues of poverty and obesity, although he made it at a church to St Jude, the patron saint of lost causes. And I remember saying to him, look, you're going to lose your deposit here, or taunting him that might happen. And it looks like it hasn't done, that their vote will go up. And it's an illustration, I think, that seats like this used to be no-go areas in the past.
Well, I was struck by that quote from Murdo Fraser, the Conservatives' deputy leader in Scotland earlier, that you used to take your life in your hands if you walked these streets with a blue rosette.
Yes, I mean, okay, their vote won't, you know, it'll be less than 10% probably, but it's turning things round in areas like this in a way that none of Mr Cameron's predecessors for a very long time have managed to do, and it will give the party extra oomph and heart. The Lib Dems, I think, were there. I mean, it was interesting. Their candidate was a pretty strong candidate. I mean, you know, he could well be an MP one day. But their campaign, paradoxically, I thought, just lacked drive and momentum and was not the typical campaign we expect of Lib Dems in by-elections. And they're going to be leapfrogged by the Conservatives.
And does that have quite a powerful effect, do you think, John Curtice, on the national scene as the Conservatives and the Liberal Democrats vie for votes in so many parts of the country?
Well, can I cast a slightly different picture about the Tory performance? Let's assume the Tory vote has gone up to about 10%. Now, that will be up 4 percentage points on the last election. Now, bear in mind that in British opinion polls at the moment, the Tories' vote is up by about 12 points or so. The point is that in Scotland, however, there is very little sign in the polling data of the Conservatives advancing. And in truth, if the Conservative vote only goes up by 3 or 4 percentage points, the conclusion we should draw is that the Cameron effect is still very limited in Scotland. This should be a by-election in which, frankly, given the advance of the Conservatives across the country as a whole, they should be at least well into the teens. Now, maybe they've done that, but if they haven't, in truth, the message is the SNP are stealing from the Conservatives the ability to profit from Labour's unpopularity north of the border.
OK, well, this is what the third, fourth by-election we've had in recent times. And, Jon Sopel, how will this one be measured, watched, in comparison with those others?
Governments, you know, the Scottish Government here in Scotland, and you've got the government at Westminster, and so I kind of think that there'll be a hue and cry over the coming days about this. But I wonder, kind of, you know, one of the things that Gordon Brown has done right is that he's managed to have by-elections at a time when the political heat seems to evaporate quite quickly, because after the Crewe and Nantwich by-election, there was the Whit break and Parliament wasn't sitting and the MPs were away for a week. And so by the time that they came back, it had all sort of dissipated a little bit. And now, of course, the House of Commons has risen and we'll have to wait until party conferences when everybody, the clans, come together again. Although Douglas Alexander has pointed out to me that there are an awful lot of people in Warwick waiting for the National Policy Forum who are watching us tonight and are tuned in and not that happy, I would imagine.
Well, let's wait and see the result. I think they're probably growing almost as impatient as your studio panel here to actually wait for the final decision.
Impatient? We're loving every second of this. Murdo, let me just invite you to take on John Curtice.
Yeah.
That the result, if with all the caveats, is that you've put on 4 points on the general election, big deal.
Oh, come on. You know, we talked a lot earlier about the third and fourth party squeeze in the by-election. You know, we met Tories who said we'd vote Tory, but we're going to tactically vote SNP in this by-election because we want to get Labour out in their best place to do that. Now, up against that third and fourth party squeeze, if we've actually not just held our share of the vote, but even increased it, as John Curtice was suggesting, I think that is stupendous. And if we've gone from fourth to third place, overtaking the Liberal Democrats, it shows that the Tories have got momentum in Scotland. And let's remember, there's a whole clutch of Labour-held seats in Scotland where the challengers are the Conservatives. And that means they all come into play for a general election. And we'll be the people that the voters will be coalescing around to get Labour out of these seats when the general election comes round. So if things turn out as John Curtice said, it's good news.
So how many seats do you think you could gain at the general election here in Scotland?
Well, we've said, realistically, we're looking at anything between 4 and 10 gains.
Right, OK, we're going to judge you on that. We're going to come back here in Pacific Quay in Glasgow after the general election and see whether that's turned out. Let me just...
We'll look forward to that.
Yeah, well, good. Excellent. My impatient panel, this is the scene in the hall where we're awaiting the result. It does look at an advanced state of readiness, but if you've got people sort of arguing over spoilt ballot papers or this sort of thing, it can take an interminable amount of time. Douglas Alexander, who has fought a number of by-elections, give me your, with the benefit of all your wisdom, where do you think we are in terms of declaration?
I think we're probably at the point at which a very small number of ballot papers are still being argued over. That perhaps explains why the candidates are not visible. They'll be talking with the electoral agents, but by this stage the candidates have got a pretty clear idea as to what's actually happening. If I can make one other point, though, just in response to what Michael Crick said earlier, it's becoming quite fashionable, admittedly within some sections of the Labour Party and certainly amongst the media, to attack the organisation of the Labour Party. And I just think it would be remiss of me this evening as a cabinet minister not to place on record what I've seen over the last 3 weeks in Glasgow East, which is a party staff who are as dedicated and committed as they were on the 1st of May 1997. If we bear responsibility for tonight's result, it's the politicians, not the organisers, not the volunteers, who were out there at 5 o'clock this morning, have worked every weekend of this campaign. If you want an antidote to the cynicism that exists about politics today, you should meet some of the volunteers who were working, certainly in the Labour Party, and to be fair, I imagine in the other parties as well over the last 3 weeks.
Isn't this an interesting... This is a very interesting area that we can now spend some time over because it's 20 past one in the morning and we go into real sort of political anorak territory, which is that... Which we... people, look, anyone who's still up at 20 past one in the morning, no, we are grateful to you being with us, I promise you. But isn't this an area where if you start shrinking in local government and you start losing council seats, there is a slight view at Westminster, it doesn't matter, as long as we still win general elections, that's all that matters.
Well, can candidates and agents please make their way across to the left-hand side of the count centre, please?
As predicted.
That's a good sign. That means that they have now got the finalised numbers and they are calling the agents and candidates together just for one last checking that everyone accepts that this is the result and that the returning officer will be coming to the stage very soon. So we're going to stay on that picture, but just Douglas Alexander, it does matter, back to anorak questions, it does matter if you start losing your base in local government because the activists drift off and then you've got to fight elections and there aren't those numbers of people to knock on doors and to deliver the leaflets.
Of course, that's a fair point. I mean, many parties nowadays are trying to make up for the loss of membership by a combination of money and technology. But actually, along with all the direct mail, all the computer systems, it still comes down to the capacity to turn people out, to be knocking on doors, to be bringing voters to the polling station. And we saw a lot of that in the last 3 weeks, not just from the Labour Party, but from other parties in this by-election.
Just for the record, the SNP is not losing membership. We're probably the only party, in, not just in Scotland, but across the UK, that has actually got a rising membership. Where I would agree with Douglas is that the party foot soldiers, you know, do an absolutely sterling job, and, you know, the SNP have had experiences of by-elections lost, and it's not the fault of those who campaign so hard. But, you know, I'd put on record my absolute amazement and gratitude and complete awe at the monumental effort that the SNP has put in to this by-election over the last couple of weeks. I fought my first by-election, campaigned in my first by-election in Govan in 1988, and I think this by-election campaign has surpassed even that, which was a tremendous by-election.
Just while we're waiting on this, I just wonder whether you think the next general election, all of you, I mean, this is not a party political question, will be fought very differently, maybe learning their lessons. And we were talking about, rather jokingly, about Barack Obama earlier. But I mean, you know, having been out in the States and seen some of what they're doing and the internet and all the rest of it and the way they use it to, and Facebook and everything else, do you think that British politics is slightly lagging behind in the use of technology?
I do, and most people think it's about fundraising. The most interesting feature of the Obama campaign is how he's almost turned the organisation inside out, so that instead of it being a small group of people at the party headquarters controlling the organisation, he's used the internet to say, listen, you are the organisation. He's handing over phone numbers, he's handing over email addresses. And using technology, he's actually empowered a whole new base of people right across the United States who in record numbers are not just donating, but are actually organising, chapping on doors, trying to persuade their neighbours to vote.
Yeah.
Can I say, I think personality is going to become even more important at the coming general election. I think people will see it as a contest between David Cameron and Gordon Brown, assuming Gordon Brown, of course, is still in office at the time of the next election. And I think the public will see that as a very close contest between two very different personalities, and I have no doubt who's going to come out on top.
OK, that wasn't strictly my question that I was asking you to address, but at 1:24, I'm not surprised. I'm talking about the way you fight in a general election campaign. I thought, yes, about the technology. You know, it used to be stuffing envelopes and delivering them on doorsteps.
There'll still be a lot of that. There'll still be a lot of that, but Douglas is right. The new media will increasingly play an important part. For example, contacting people by text message is something which is coming more and more to the fore. Using Facebook, using internet sites, much more sophisticated campaigning, targeted at the sort of people who don't vote. For example, the 18 to 24s are very poor actually coming out to vote. These are the people who the new technology is most likely to be able to reach.
I think there's a great role for new technology, and, you know, I do podcasts and have websites and Facebook and everything else. And I think certainly with younger people, if you think about where they get their news from, then they probably are as likely to go to the BBC website as to pick up a newspaper and use the internet for that. And indeed, if they want to find out about the different party policies, they're as likely to go to Google and type in the name of their local area. But I don't think we can get away from the importance of the on-the-ground campaigning, of the personal contact with voters that we have in each constituency around the UK. And in a time when cynicism is rising about politics, I think one of the most effective ways to combat that is actually being face to face with somebody and having that conversation and really listening to what that person says. I think there's a danger with this increasing reliance on technology or telephoning or just direct mail, that in fact we're creating another barrier between the sort of the politicians in a little bubble and the people on the ground. And politicians need to stay in the real world, and the best way to do that is to get out on the doorsteps.
Murdo, I mean, we hear about what's happening at Conservative Central Office with sort of the Ashcroft money going to sort of target certain constituencies. Did you get any of his money for this constituency?
I'm afraid I'm not privy to the funding of the campaign, so I'll need to give a pass on that particular question. But of course, let's just remember that Ashcroft money is all about levelling the playing field between incumbents in the main Labour MPs who have a very generous communications allowance and are able to use that to promote themselves to their constituents. And the Ashcroft money is there to try and level that playing field in favour of the challenger.
OK, I just want to talk about the pictures that we're looking at. These are agents apparently gathered round. All I want to see is nodding heads. I don't want to see anyone shaking their head, because if it's a shaken head, it means that they're not happy and they want to do something different. And the next thing, of course, we want to see is the returning officer striding confidently towards a microphone and to start delivering that result. There is the microphone in the centre there that we're hoping he will come to in just a moment. We were hearing from Aileen that it was likely to be between 20 past and half past one. If it's going to be before half past one, he'd better get a move on because he's got 3 minutes. Glenn, when do you reckon it's going to be? Come on, let's have a should we have a sweepstake now when the result is going to be declared?
I reckon that it's going to be declared at 1:35.
Oh, hang on, there may be movement. There may be movement towards the stage, is there? No, another false dawn. Another false dawn in the long wait for a by-election result declaration. I don't know whether the agent is going back now. Please let there not be a recount, because that would be...
I think that nobody's mentioned the R word yet.
Yeah, exactly. This could be... Yeah, the R word is that it suddenly the result gets declared at 3 o'clock in the... Oh. Well, I wonder what is going on, because actually the conversation seems to be rather animated, and maybe this is not as clear-cut as perhaps early indications had been led to believe, because this is a... Douglas Alexander, try and deconstruct that for us, please.
Well, you can see there Margaret Curran, our candidate, Colin Smith, who's the General Secretary of the Labour Party in Scotland, and a couple of local supporters. Beyond that, because they're facing in the wrong direction, I can't give you any indication.
If you let Glasgow know, it's looking like there's possibly a recount.
Right. I'm hearing words...
The R word.
I'm hearing the R word of a recount. So this could turn into a very jolly and late night for everybody there at the count. For those of you at home, if you want determined to stay up to wait for the result, and for all our panellists who are waiting, because it does look as if this is not the sign. There's obviously some discussion going on about, right, what are we going to do about this? And I don't know whether it's spoiled ballot papers, I don't know whether it is, I don't know whether we can get any light on it. I would think, Douglas Alexander, what is the lowest margin that you'd call a recount on?
Well, I mean, I think the indications are this will be very tight. Why it can appear that even with a relatively larger number, say in the hundreds, that a recount still could be called for, is because the practice of counting votes involves putting together bundles of votes. So if you simply misplace one bundle, which you presumed was for Joan Mason and in fact turned out was for Margaret Curran or vice versa, then that actually can have a very significant effect.
I don't know whether there is an announcement being made. I'm hearing rumours that there is going to be a full recount, and this could mean that the result is going to drift ever later. I'm sort of looking at... Glenn, I don't know what you're hearing.
Well, it certainly looks that way, and I overheard somebody who sounded not unlike David Cairns, the Scotland Office Minister, mention the word recount. There's certainly been much discussion at the count. I think one of the key things is obviously who is it that's calling for the count. That might well tell us which way the first count has gone and who has the upper hand at this stage. Let's find out more from Aileen Clarke, who's at the count. What light can you shed on this situation?
Well, I'm afraid the R word, as you say, is definitely being talked about here. We are hearing there may well be a recount. We don't know the details of why or who's called for one or anything, but that is certainly what they're talking about here at the moment. There was, as usual in these affairs, as you know, Glenn, the returning officer takes the candidates to the side of the stage and they have their little chat, and then normally what happens is they all file up onto the stage and we get the results.
Okay,
but
well,
this time they went and had their little chat and then they all split up, and now what we're hearing is it looks like there may well be a recount.
And obviously, recounts are generally called for when things are pretty close. We're hearing that it may be as close as a few hundred votes. A nationalist majority of 354. Perhaps one of the problems with that, Professor John Curtice, is that there are not one but two Currans on the ballot paper.
Well, certainly if the majority is as small as that, then even if indeed, as we expect, Frances Curran hasn't done terribly well, but the Scottish Socialist candidate, her name appeared just above that of Margaret Curran. Now, I guess one of the reasons why Labour Party might want a recount in those situations is perhaps there's also a slightly greater danger that perhaps some of the ballot papers have ended up in the wrong pile, question mark. But certainly more generally, the Labour Party have always had some worry about whether or not some voters who really wanted for Margaret Curran, seeing Frances Curran coming first in the ballot paper above Margaret Curran, would vote for her instead. And of course, this is a constituency which may go back to the fiasco of the Scottish Parliament election, the high incidence of spoiled ballot papers. This was the place where there was the largest incidence of spoiled ballot papers and where therefore perhaps voters are more likely to be confused.
Well, this is old-fashioned technology, the traditional ballot paper, Jon Sopel, but it is still possible if you're a voter to make mistakes when you've got two Currans on the ballot paper, and still possible for those counting to make mistakes too.
Yeah, Glenn, and let me just demonstrate to you why the Labour Party is so concerned about this. Look, this is the leaflet that they were handing out at the polling station today. Today's polling day, don't forget to vote, Margaret Curran standing up for the East End. They say then, Margaret Curran, number three on the ballot paper, because above that, at number two, is Frances Curran from the Scottish Socialist Party. And what seems to have happened is that Frances Curran has polled more than the number of votes that the SNP lead the Labour Party. And therefore, they want to have a recount to see if some of those Frances Curran votes have mistakenly been put in the wrong pile and should have gone to Margaret Curran. And that this leaflet is absolutely there. Margaret Curran is number three underlined on the ballot paper because Labour were clearly worried that some people might go in, think, I'm a Labour supporter, I've got to vote for Curran, and they vote for the wrong Curran. And Douglas Alexander, I don't know whether that's what you're understanding, and I know you...
I mean, like everybody else, we're getting indications in terms of what's happening. What I can tell you confidently is the result is very close. I'm not in a position to tell you whether Labour's asking for a recount because I simply don't know. I can tell you in the campaign we were understandably concerned with two candidates with the identical surname to do our best to make sure to differentiate between them, and that explains the leaflet that we were producing and making sure was being handed out today.
Nicola Sturgeon, I wonder what you're hearing.
All I've heard is that there is going to be a recount. And for viewers, sometimes a recount doesn't involve going through the whole process again. It can just be checking bundles, so we don't know yet what extent of a recount is taking place. I suppose the other thing that's worth pointing out for people watching at home is that I'm sure when people hear the word recount, they think, well, you know, there could be votes in single figures separating two parties. Parties can call for recounts when the majority, as it appears, is in the hundreds. So it doesn't mean that it's closer than that. It also doesn't mean, of course, that people who've voted for Frances Curran haven't done so perfectly legitimately and that all of her votes are correct. So, you know, we're probably no further forward in terms of getting the result here, and I suspect all that we know for sure is that all of us are going to be sitting here for quite some time longer.
Does it start to make the decision of your candidate to come in and waving his arms aloft maybe seem a tad on the premature side?
Can I say that, well, let's see, I'm still feeling very happy with how things are going this evening, but, you know, at the start of this campaign, if anybody had even predicted that we would be in a recount scenario, and I think if they had predicted that, they would probably have predicted it on the basis of the SNP asking for a recount from behind. So, you know, already tonight we know that there has been a seismic shift here and that there has been a significant shift towards the SNP. So, yes, I do think John Mason was right to celebrate in the way he did, and I think he deserves a great deal of credit for the campaign he's fought.
OK, well, if you've only just joined us, this is what happened about an hour ago when John Mason arrived. I think we can show you these pictures now. Here he is walking into the hall. And that is an hour before we have a result. And what we have now is a recount. So those photos... And there he is walking in, sort of being greeted and as the clear victor. And I think we could even cut now to a picture of Margaret Curran, who is there locked in conversation, and presumably feeling that it was worth their while calling for this recount. And as we heard Nicola saying, that it doesn't necessarily mean that they have to start all over again. It could be just the verification of certain bundles, but this is obviously going to delay us somewhat. I'll read you a text that I've just had sent to me. I don't know who it's from. For goodness sake, chill out, kick back, open a beer, light a ciggy. This could be a cool, long, enjoyable wait. Just think of it as a party. Now, I don't know whether you've ever worked for the BBC, but do you know how many rules I would be breaking if I just chilled out, kicked back, opened a beer and lit a ciggy in BBC premises? A career...
Well, a ciggy, certainly. It's a public place. They're not allowed. But
yeah, I tell you what, I don't think my bosses would take kindly to a beer, although maybe they would understand it given the circumstances. Yeah. And the Scottish Health Minister, presumably you would take a pretty dim view.
I would frown on all of that.
All of
it? As a Scottish Health Minister, absolutely.
Except enjoying it and turning it into a party.
Except the party if I ever get out of here tonight.
Yeah, exactly. Have you heard any more? I mean, I know that text messages have been coming in and BlackBerries have been buzzing and whatever else. No.
We're all in the dark together.
We know no more, and it's a shame, actually, because what I'd love to see is whether what they're doing with those bundles. We can see, I can see Margaret Curran there, and we wait on this. And there she is. And there we go. That's where the counting is, presumably. But they haven't, I mean, you can still see there are bundles there. So it doesn't look to me like it is what you'd call a full recount, because presumably then you'd just be starting again. I'm looking to anybody here of my panellists on either side who would like to speculate on what they think is going on. Murdo.
I suspect what they might be doing is a bundle check, yeah. which is where they simply pick up the bundles, they flick through them to check that there aren't any papers there with the wrong cross on them, and they restack them. That's a big difference from actually individually recounting every single vote. That'll be much quicker. And going back to your point about the two Currans, of course, if there are ballot papers there with a cross against Francis Curran's name, that is a vote for Francis Curran. That's the end of the story. Nobody's got any way of knowing whether the voter who put that cross meant to vote for Margaret Curran or not. We've got to take that at face value for being a vote for Francis Curran. End of story.
Of course, but it does make it easier for mistakes to be made within the count, that a whole bundle with one Francis Curran paper at the top could actually then be votes from Margaret Curran, or vice versa, obviously. But it just it adds a potential element of confusion within the count itself, because these people are counting thousands of ballots very quickly.
Can I say it will be very tense in the Leisure Centre this evening as they're counting it. And if I can tell you that in a previous by-election, a famous contest between Labour and the SNP, George Robertson, the victor in that by-election, found himself negotiating with the returning officer. And given the lateness of the hour, I still don't think it would be appropriate for me to describe exactly what was written in that small square. Let's just use the word hopeless instead of the word that was actually used. But written in microtype was, they're all hopeless, but he's less hopeless than the rest of them. And this was being negotiated with the returning officer
about whether it was
regarded as a statement of intent in favour of the election of George Robertson. So I sincerely hope that there are not 300, 400, 500, 600 equivalent lines being negotiated at the moment. I think Murdo's probably right. I think what's likely to be happening at this stage, although that may indicate that they're going for a more comprehensive look than simply a bundle count.
They could, of course, be, if it is the current situation, then what they might do is simply take Francis Curran's votes and check that there are no Margaret Curran votes in them. That might not take as long as it would take if there was a full recount underway.
We are building a mountain of speculation here on what is going on inside that Leisure Centre.
What it will actually turn out to be is a recount between the Tories and the Liberals for third place.
Why can't the returning officer just simply go to the microphone and say, I know there's a lot of people here waiting, this is what's going on? Or is there any reason?
That would seem
representation of the People's Act.
That would seem
Act
a rational.
Like.
This would seem a rational act, but given the degree of vulnerability you feel as a candidate at this point in the evening, I don't think there will be many people rushing to the returning officer with suggestions. They'll be allowing the returning officer to go about and do their job.
I want this to be like when you're on a train and the customer services manager comes on and tells you there is a points failure or there is something on the line, and that is why there is
usually
an unavoidable
hours delay.
Yeah,
so
that means there is an
like
unavoidable.
That.
I'm not sure that's the benchmark of accuracy.
No.
No.
It reminds
reminds me a little bit of the Holyrood elections last year when I was on a similar panel, and we were just waiting for the results to come in, and then eventually one or two returning officers did decide to go and make an announcement to say the problem with the voting software and everything, and I think I ended up being here till 5:30 in the morning, so I'm hopeful that it won't take quite as long this evening.
And the final results weren't declared till 5:30 the following day, so let's hope it's not like that.
I fear televisions are being switched off all across the nation.
Hey, 5:30.
I think we will probably have a result a lot earlier than 5:30, so I think the viewers should stick with us.
I think that was a rather Jeremiah comment from Ms. Swinson there about the idea of 5:30 in the morning. I'm sure they're going to make swift progress. I'm just kind of reading what's on the Press Association wires just flashed. The crucial Glasgow East by-election was on a knife edge tonight after a full recount was ordered. Amid rumours that the SNP had pulled off a stunning upset by securing a majority of around 350, the returning officer agreed to a Labour request for the ballots to be studied again. And then it just goes on about the history of the seat. And it does look like they are taking out quite a lot. Well, maybe those are just the current votes that they are looking at. Maybe this is a full recount. I would love to seek enlightenment. I don't know whether we've been able to find out from Aileen, who's there at the count, the full detail of what is going on. Glenn, I don't know whether you've got an idea of kind of whether Mr. Curtice and Mr. Crick there, I can see with you, can shed any more enlightenment.
Well,
sure.
My reading of the pictures, John, is that they're not just taking papers off the two current piles, they are taking papers off all the piles. We've just seen pictures of them taking papers from the Mason pile, and they're not just checking that indeed, you know, the bundles, they're checking the individual ballot papers in each case. So it is in effect, I think, a full recount. They are checking, therefore, obviously what Margaret Caron must be hoping for, assuming that it is indeed her that's called for it, is that there aren't just some of her papers muddled up with Francis Caron's, but perhaps there are others of hers elsewhere, or indeed equally, that papers have been put into John Mason's pile that shouldn't be there.
That means that because during the course of the count, or at some point they might have seen one, you know, in the Francis Curran pile, a Margaret Curran vote, and therefore they want verification of the whole thing.
Well, yes, or just simply that, you know, given that if indeed the result is relatively close, and given the additional danger that if indeed the first ballot paper in a bundle is for perhaps the is for one county and the ones underneath are for somebody different, there's potentially quite a serious error. They're frankly looking to check that indeed the whole thing is right.
Right. Okay. And yes. And any idea how long this might take, Mr. Curtice?
I would not be surprised if we are still here until something like 3 o'clock or so. That's very much a guess, but given how methodically they seem to be leafing through each of those individual ballot papers, doubtless Aileen Clarke will give us a clue. But you can see there, they're closely looking through each individual one. And if it's as close as we think it is, I imagine the returning officer's instructions are to make sure that this is indeed correct.
Yeah, and that process could obviously take some time. I'm sort of, I don't know why, but memories of the Winchester election in the 1997 general election are coming back to me, where that went on all night, and the Tories lost it by 2, didn't they, and then challenged it in the High Court, and then lost it by something like 21,000.
It was Jerry Malone, of course.
Jerry Malone,
erstwhile of Scotland, who was run out of Scotland and then was run out of Winchester.
Yeah.
I am being told, for what it's worth, although I accept the pictures would tell a different story, that it's not a full recount, that it is a bundle check. That's what my latest news from
your latest bit of hot. So you think it is a bundle?
Well, that's what I've been told. I mean, I have to say the pictures would look to me to be slightly different.
I want to bring in Stephen Purcell here, who is the leader of Glasgow City Council. These are your staff, aren't they, working there?
Well, for tonight's purposes, are the staff of the people and not of the leader of the council. You will understand.
That was
I want
a good
to be absolutely
answer.
Clear
Douglas
about that,
like
John.
That.
It doesn't look like a full recount, as you would understand a full recount. To me, it does look as if the bundles are being checked, which will involve going through the papers very quickly. A full recount would take us back to that stage of actually separating papers. I was kind of heartened earlier when we thought it was just the checking of the currents, although I was going to interject and say to Nicola, in fairness, I'm sure they would have had to have checked Margaret Curran once for Francis Curran's papers as well. So
I'm sure Francis would insist upon it.
Well, that was the point I was just going to make, knowing Francis Curran as we all do. I'm sure we would have.
Right, OK. Well, this is obviously going to be something of an evening, and we're going to spend lots of time now to expand on all sorts of interesting topics as we watch this all unfold and look at our wonderful panoramic view of us here in Glasgow at the BBC's Broadcasting Centre in here in the centre of the city. And we're waiting for the results of that by-election, and it looks like it's all going to take quite a little bit of time to come. Fiona, let me bring you back in here, because I think that you've seen a few by-elections in your time.
And thank you.
Thank you. No, that was said. That was said because you are a person of wisdom and sagacity. Did I get myself out of that hole?
Not really, because you've probably seen about as many as I have.
Yeah.
Your point was?
What do you think's happening?
I've absolutely no idea.
Oh, it's so lovely. It's so refreshing when people are really honest with answers at this time.
Well, I mean, they're obviously checking the votes, but we don't really know what they're checking.
Yeah.
So, what can I say?
Murray, I suspect that Scottish elections, you've seen a few interesting counts going on.
I don't remember one quite like this, because if this was a recount, a full recount, he would have announced it.
No.
And there's been no announcement.
No, they don't have to announce it. It's at the discretion of the returning officer, who can, frankly, do what he likes.
I can't imagine a recount where they haven't actually said we're having a recount.
I don't think it's not a full recount. I mean, you can begin to see it as the bundles that are being checked.
Yeah.
So,
you sure about that, Nicola?
Well, I'm not 100% sure, but it's beginning to look, as well as what I've been told, it's beginning to look now as if that is what they're doing.
So it's interesting, because it used to be the case that under the Representation of the People's Act, I think we weren't allowed to be even down on the floor when a count was taking place. We used to be on the sort of, elevated platform, and we weren't allowed to cross down to where the count was taking place because we couldn't interfere with the purity of the count. But I've seen
it depended on the returning officer. Some would let you onto the floor to take pictures. Others, some of them actually had you out in the corridor, and you were not even allowed to take photographs or camera shots in the count itself. Individual journalists might be allowed to go in, but you were very often kept well away from the voting paper so you couldn't actually see anything.
Stephen, you couldn't ring up the returning officer for us, could you, and just see if he could get a quick word and find out what's happening?
Absolutely not.
I thought that would be the disappointing reply.
He's also the returning officer for my own election, and as Douglas said earlier, no candidates ever like to fall out with the returning officer. We follow his advice very, very carefully. But I don't think it will be very long. It's clearly just a bundle check, and you can see that the piles of the ballot papers are beginning to be put back into the brown boxes.
I tell you what, then, if you can't phone him, why don't you give me his number? And I'll phone him.
See, it is turning into a party. That's what this guy said. Turn it into a party. It's turning into a party. Yeah, it's very interesting that as we're watching this, does there ever come a point, Douglas Alexander, where you're at a count and you think, this isn't going to make any difference to the result, but actually it might get us even closer to the finishing line? Or do you only do it when you believe, genuinely, hand on heart, that the result could change?
I think the responsible course is to do it if you think you can change the result. And again, even if the result is in hundreds, because by this stage of the count, the bundles are in bundles of 100, it's quite possible with two bundles being put in one pile inadvertently when they should have been in another.
Have you seen that
happen?
That
would have a material change. Yeah, I have seen circumstances where there has been a bundle which has been in the wrong pile. Now, in that sense, I don't know quite how close it is. Clearly, if there's a bundle check taking place, it's close enough that it has to be within the bounds of possibility. I'm sure partly because the returning officer has discretion, and also because obviously you would expect the agents of all the political parties to be acting in a reasonably responsible way.
Why don't we just have electronic voting?
There's a particular history to
ask
to that.
More about that.
Now that I raised that question.
Well, there was a process in the 2007 elections which reflected recommendations that came from the Arbuthnot Commission, that followed a process whereby in Parliament, I remember, Jo, I think you served on the standing committee and spoke in favour of it. There was a broad cross-party consensus in favour of it. And at about this point in the evening, indeed before this point in the evening, there were simultaneously problems because certain of the ballot counting machines broke down, and also because there was genuine disputes where, because the forms were within the machine, people felt there wasn't the degree of transparency and visibility that we've actually just seen on the screens just now. Now, there's been extensive consultation and discussion afterwards. There was a full kind of report into those events. But I think that explains in part why, for all that it may seem like a very long process this evening, many of us who were in some ways scarred by the experience of 2007 recognise the importance of there being certainty about how people vote. And in that sense, that can sometimes mean checking bundles. It can sometimes mean having a discussion with a returning officer in terms of whether the will of the individual has been properly represented if the cross goes across part of the square. But these are serious matters and they deserve serious consideration.
Yes, I mean, there was a hue and cry about all of that, and I'm sure you still feel that you carry...
I remember it well.
..some of the scars from that. But is then, you know, when we allow all our bank transactions to carry out online and, you know, where we move around our own personal money and all sorts of stuff, that there is no way that we can do this that is satisfactory?
Well, I wouldn't rush to say let's introduce electronic voting in Scotland, but you're right, of course, that you can have systems that allow the degree of integrity that you need in an election. Part of the difficulty in 2007 was you simultaneously had a decision reached in the Scottish Parliament to have the local government elections on the same day as the Scottish Parliament
election. It was much
more
complicated.
So there were two electoral systems and different ballot papers. Actually, the level of spoilt papers in Scotland at that election was less than in the previous mayoral election in London, where Ken Livingstone had been elected. But I think, to be perfectly honest, and with the benefit of hindsight, in part because the failure was so visible, people could see on their screens ballot machines not working. There was obviously a very high level of concern for very understandable reasons, which, as I say, I hope has not permanently retarded the possibility that we could innovate in our electoral systems, but I think has caused people to pause and think very seriously, both about whether it's sensible to have two different kinds of elections on the same day, and secondly, how do we make sure that the counts are actually done in a sensible way?
Nicola Sturgeon, what do you think? Do you think that there is a role for... I mean, it's interesting because, you know, 20 minutes ago when we were in those sunny uplands of thinking that the result was just about to be announced and we were just waiting for the returning officer to appear, we were talking about kind of some of the technological advances that we're going to be borrowing from America in campaigning to sort of, you know, revolutionise the way politics runs. And here we are sort of defending people sticking one of those things at the end of their finger and, you know, counting like that.
I mean, I think Douglas is right, although he was responsible for the election fiasco last year. But he's right in the sense that, you know, there was more than electronic counting at fault, although there were big problems with the counting machines. But there were also issues about the two elections on the same day, the design of the ballot paper, which I think most people think was responsible for the high level of spoiled ballot papers. There is a role for electronic counting. We elect our local authorities by single transferable vote. I don't think any of us would relish the prospect of sitting in a programme like this where we try to manually count single transferable vote. It is done in some places. But I do think there is a transparency around manual counting that for first past the post elections, where it can be done relatively quickly, normally, and relatively easily, I would be loath to see go. And I do think the current system we've got has a lot to commend it.
OK, there we are. We will mull a little bit further. I know Glenn wants to mull a little bit further of that and the whole question of how our votes are counted. Glenn?
Well, if you've just tuned in, I think it's worth pointing out that we're going to stick with this by-election until the end, until we get a result. What we know so far is that 42.25% of those entitled to vote in Glasgow East have turned out. The ballots have been cast and they've been counted for the very first time. We think that that count has resulted in an SNP victory, a narrow margin of victory of perhaps just over 300 votes, but we're now into a recount situation. What we're not sure about is how big a recount we're now looking at, whether it's a full recount or whether some of the bundles are being checked. perhaps to see whether any of Margaret Curran's votes have got caught up in bundles for the Scottish Socialist Party candidate, who's also called Curran, Francis Curran. Let's see if we can shed a bit more light on that now with our reporter at The Count, Aileen.
Well, I can shed a bit more light on it for you because I've just spoken to the returning officer himself and posed that question. So what kind of recount are we having, I asked him. And he said, well, as far as I'm concerned, this is a full recount. He said every single bundle is being opened up and checked. So it's very thorough. That's what he says he's doing. Every bundle is being checked. The good news, however, is that his latest prediction is we will get the results and we'll get the candidates on the stage in about another 10 minutes.
Right, well, that certainly would be a fairly quick recount, albeit that it is a full recount with every vote and every bundle being checked. Can we confirm who has called for the recount and what the bone of contention is?
Yes, as far as I understand it, it is Labour who have called for the recount. There is quite a narrow margin here, just a few hundred votes between themselves and the SNP, and they wanted just to make sure that was absolutely right. Also, as you've been discussing, there was this concern that as there is two Currans effectively on the ballot paper, they just wanted to make sure that the right Currans had ended up in the right bundle as well. So there was that was really, I think, to be honest with you, a secondary consideration. The main consideration was there's just a few hundred votes in it. Labour want to make sure that the count is absolutely right before they would concede to the SNP.
I wonder whether you think, Professor John Curtice, that this is worth all the bother.
It's always worth the bother to make sure that all the parties are satisfied that we have got the right winner. After all, I mean, we may now be feeling it more than painful having to sit here for a bit longer, but for simply getting the result a half an hour, 45 minutes late, to make sure particularly that the losing candidate accepts that she has lost, if indeed she has lost, it seems to me well worth the effort. Because we, as has already been discussed by the other panel, if people are not sure that indeed the count's been conducted properly, then all sorts of arguments start to fly about whether or not indeed the people who won did indeed actually win.
I suppose, Michael Crick, this is worth the bother because it's not just about who gets to be MP for Glasgow East. Maybe Gordon Brown's political future rests on those few hundred votes and whether they've been counted accurately or not.
Well, certainly that was what people were saying at the start of the campaign, although, interestingly, I don't think commentators have said that quite as much over the last couple of weeks. And I think if the SNP have won tonight, certainly those Labour MPs who were questioning Brown's leadership will be coming out and doing so again. And of course, there will be 300 odd Labour MPs who will be thinking, crikey, my majority is actually less than that on this result. My seat's in danger as well. And it'll be interesting to see whether new names start coming out over the weekend and questioning Mr. Brown's leadership. We were discussing before whether actually the fact that MPs aren't at Westminster for the next couple of months, whether that means that the level of plotting and fervour dies down. But, you know, remember 2 years ago in the summer of 2006, when we saw the Blair letters, the two letters written by backbenchers, that all happened while Parliament wasn't sitting. All the fervour earlier this year about the 10 pence tax increase, that occurred during the Easter recess. So just because MPs aren't at Westminster doesn't stop them phoning each other and contacting each other by emails and so on. But I think one of the reasons why this by-election was called quickly, and we were discussing this with John earlier, was in order to get it out of the way before MPs go on their holidays. But that could well backfire.
I was thinking of Lassimer as well, and the trouble that emerged for David Cameron. That
of
built
course.
Up again
yes.
over the summer period, and it has done for the Lib Dems in the past as well. And we were talking a little bit about the tactics that were employed in the campaign and the party machines. Do you think that this by-election has been fought in a very traditional way, John Curtice, or is it the modern technology that has made the difference for the SNP, whether they win or not? They certainly seem to have had a big swing.
I think the SNP campaign can be characterised as the appliance of modern technology to traditional methods. If you went into the SNP headquarters, you were immediately aware of high use of computers, clearly use of telephones, but it was clearly a campaign that was directed towards trying to get the vote out. Now, I think most of us would argue that, as it were, in terms of the substance of the campaign, the various television debates between the various candidates, the SNP campaign, in that sense, never really caught fire. And I think if indeed they've won it very narrowly indeed, we will probably conclude that a crucial ingredient to their ability to win was their ability to get their vote out. And that, of course, does depend on local organisation, albeit assisted by modern technology.
A 24% swing is what we're talking about, which is a huge margin for John Mason, if indeed that's what he gets. There he is on the left of picture, still looking pretty happy, pretty confident, I think, about his prospects despite this recount. And you know, one of the funny things about him as a candidate is his name. He's John Mason, and he's joked in the past, if indeed he was joking, that he would never just put Mason on the poster in somewhere like the East End of Glasgow, because there is a strong Catholic community in that part of the country, and perhaps he might be punished by those of a sectarian bent.
Yes, and indeed some people were saying this was a much tougher by-election for the SNP compared with the two governments because of the high number of Catholics in the constituency. Although interestingly, actually, a couple of people I was talking to at polling stations tonight were saying actually one of the reasons they were voting for John Mason is because of his anti-abortion views. So it doesn't necessarily go the way that one might always think.
The two things to say about it. I mean, the first, of course, is that John Mason is a practicing Protestant. I think he was the only practicing Christian amongst the principal candidates, and because he was the only one who stood out against the embryology bill and the only one who was in favour of reducing the time limit for abortion. In a sense, his position, although he's a Protestant, was actually closer to that of the Catholic Church. But I think the second thing to say, although it is true that the Labour Party in Scotland generally does better amongst Catholics than amongst the rest of the population in Scotland, it has not been true for some considerable time that the SNP itself necessarily does worse amongst Catholics than it does amongst Protestants. It's actually the Conservative Party they won't vote for.
You could say that the SNP in recent times has been courting the so-called Catholic vote. But, I mean, I just wonder how realistic these terms are. I mean, the Bishop of Motherwell, Joseph Devine, made an intervention in this campaign and attacked Labour's moral record over, for instance, the embryology bill. But does that mean that the almost a third of voters in Glasgow East who are Catholic automatically sit up and take notice and say, won't vote Labour this time?
There are two things to say about this. The first is that not all Catholics follow the position of the Catholic Church. For example, recent survey data shows that around a half of Catholics now think there is virtually nothing wrong at all with sexual relations between two men. That's a very different position of the Catholic Church. They are still more conservative as a community than Scotland in general, but they are by no means as conservative as you might imagine about the Catholic Church. The second thing to say is that if you want to understand why there is a bond traditionally between the Labour Party and Catholics, it's not to do with the moral issues, it's to do with essentially the Labour Party, of course, is a party that's associated with social justice, and another important part of Catholic teaching is also in favour of social justice. And Catholics
Margaret
in Scotland
Cullen,
are more left-wing.
Candidate, actually a former minister for social justice in the Scottish Government. But on that issue of the embryology bill and whether it was acceptable or not to create the circumstances for hybrid human-animal embryos, Margaret Curran said, having considered the issues, Michael Crick, she would vote with the government on that, whereas, as we've pointed out, John Mason, the SNP candidate, said that he would be against. Do you think that that will have played in this by-election at all? Will it have swayed some voters?
Well, some voters, but probably not in... Well, who knows? We don't know what the majority is. But, I mean, as I say, there were two tonight who said that for them that had been the decisive issue. And if the majority is only a few hundred, that could well have been what played it. I mean, it seems to me that what was fascinating about this campaign is that it was an old-fashioned campaign in many respects. I mean, a lot of the constituency hadn't been canvassed for years, if ever. There was a lot of traditional door-knocking type canvassing.
Why had a lot of the constituency not been canvassed before? Was there a sense in which this was so traditionally Labour that the party didn't actually have to work to win?
I think that's true.
In fact, hang
on a minute. Is this an announcement?
To the side of the count section. Can candidates and agents please make their way to the side of the count section, please?
Aha, now that sounds encouraging. The returning officer in Glasgow, where you're seeing pictures of the Conservative candidate, Davina Rankin, but the returning officer announcing there that he wants to see candidates and their agents at the side of the hall. That's where they're all heading now. And the last time this happened, I think we had the results of the original count, which we understand resulted in a narrow margin of victory for the SNP. Now that there has been that recount, that the ballot papers have been checked again, perhaps a final result, or what we hope will be the final result, has been reached and is about to be discussed with all the candidates and their agents. So let's hope, John Curtice, that they're going to be happy with the numbers they get this time.
Well, indeed. I mean, clearly, we're right that indeed that the anticipated majority was around 350. They would have had to have found a fairly serious mistake if indeed we're now going to discover that the result is significantly different. But as Douglas Alexander said, it can possibly happen, but as it were, the odds are against it. But we wait on tenterhooks to see.
I think if my hearing was better or our microphones were more sensitive, we might actually have a preview of the result. But as far as we're hearing so far, I don't think the result has changed very much indeed from the first count to the recount. And if that is the case, then it would be a stunning result for the Scottish National Party. It would be the first by-election that they had won from Labour in 20 years. And John Curtice, they haven't actually won a by-election at all for the Westminster Parliament since what, 95? Perth in 1995?
Indeed. Yes, I mean, we're probably looking at the third best result for the SNP since the SNP became a serious electoral force in the late 1960s. Probably the two Glasgow government victories, those two iconic victories in 1973 and 1988, are going to outpace this one. But after that, this is going to join the litany of what looks like to be great SNP successes. The SNP just probably doing enough to get that 22%.
A little bit of body language again there from John Mason, the SNP candidate, the man who would become the MP for Glasgow East. A thumbs up sign to one of the activists, presumably at the count, as he walked past, still looking pretty relaxed and confident. And I wonder, are the candidates, do you think, Michael Crick, getting ready now to take their places on the stage? Do you think we're getting close to that result?
Well, it looks that way, doesn't it? And of course, they'll. I mean, we sort of, when we do this, we sort of pretend that it's all, you know, when it's all read out on the platform, it's all news to them. But of course, they get to hear it a few minutes before we do on television. And
some of them still look quite shocked. When,
yes, I know. They all pretend it's news. And
who says politicians can't act?
And that it's joyous news or devastating news.
But I think it's worth saying, Glenn, that, you know, given that we have said a number of times tonight, it is rare for the SNP to win a by-election, to actually go so far as to actually be able to win, and certainly it's very rare indeed for them to get swings of this kind of order. It simply emphasises the scale of the disaster that Labour has suffered, if indeed, as we now anticipate, Margaret Curran has lost.
How does this compare in the list of Labour disastrous results? I mean, it's the worst since 97, is it?
It's not the worst since 97, because if you look, for example, at the Brent East by-election, the swing from Labour to Liberal Democrats was nearly 30%. In Birmingham Hodshill, it was about 27%. No, the swings in some of those Lib Dem constituencies where the Iran war in Muslim constituencies was an issue was even bigger than here. But the point is that the Liberal Democrats have always been, as it were, the protest party of by-elections. Most of the biggest swings in by-elections have been to the Liberal Democrats. Much rarer to get big swings from Labour to the SNP, or indeed, in truth, from Labour to Conservative or vice versa. So measured against those kinds of swings, it's not wholly exceptional, but it's towards the top end of the scale.
The SNP have made the breakthrough in a Westminster by-election in Glasgow twice, winning Govan in the early 1970s and then again in 1988. But in both cases, as in so many cases, yes, they handed the seat back at the general election.
But that is not the crucial point about a by-election victory. You're absolutely right. I mean, it has to be true. If you're, are we going down to the bookies tomorrow to put a bet on who will win Glasgow East in 2010, I would vote on the Labour Party. The point is that this is a signal about the depth of the government's unpopularity at the moment and the degree to which voters, even in one of its safest constituencies, are willing to use a by-election to send a message of protest. That's what by-elections help you to understand. It's not what happens in individual constituencies. And remember that indeed, although the Conservative government managed to recover some of the by-election losses between 92 and 97, they lost the general election, and that's the crucial issue.
The Labour camp still finding something to laugh about there at the count. On the left of screen, Frank Roy, Labour MP, for Motherwell and Wishaw, and also a Labour whip at Westminster, Margaret Curran, of course, and the Scotland Office Minister, David Cairns, who has pretty much run this campaign, I think it's fair to say.
Yes,
Tom,
he's been there pretty much from the beginning. In fact, the other day I was teasing him, well, why wasn't he doing his job at the Scottish Office? But
well, I guess the same question could be asked about Alex Salmond and a number of
SNP. He claims he took holiday in order to
at least I guess SNP, at least members of the Scottish Parliament had the excuse that they were indeed meant to be on holiday, at least so far as the Parliament is concerned. Though, of course, until Tuesday, Westminster.
Not a holiday, just a recess from Parliament. Time to spend with their constituents.
Indeed, time with, in the case of ministers, with their ministerial boxes. But there we go. I suspect in both cases, a certain amount of government business perhaps has not been pursued as vigorously as might otherwise have been done.
I tell you what, Michael Crick, this by-election will have done no harm at all to the bed and breakfast trade in the East End of Glasgow, because there's been all sorts of talk of activists from all over Scotland, perhaps beyond, taking a by-election holiday in the East End.
Yeah, particularly from the SNP. I think the number of activists they've had out on the streets, everybody accepts, has been a lot higher than the other parties. Although there hasn't been the influx of MPs actually that many people predicted. I've been in by-elections that have been brought in by coach.
Cabinet ministers who did turn up for this by-election did so in secrecy.
Yes, yeah,
so
there haven't been that as many ministers either. I mean, in fact, Labour didn't have any star names either yesterday or on Tuesday. And of course, that I suspect is deliberate, because of course, the more you have cabinet ministers around, the more it reminds people of the Brown government. And what Labour has deliberately done is concentrated on Margaret Curran. And she's all over the leaflets and all over the posters, her name. And it hasn't been, they've downplayed the Westminster angle.
In terms of the real issues in this campaign, things that people are genuinely worried about and want politicians to do something about, we touched on embryology perhaps being an issue for some. What other issues have played big?
I think there were clearly two big issues in this campaign. One was law and order, knife crime, antisocial behaviour, which is clearly an issue for many people in Glasgow East. The problem with that, however, is that it's very difficult for politicians to come up with promises that will indicate how things will be better. And in truth, the candidates never that seriously clashed with each other on that issue. The other obvious issue was to do with prices, fuel, the state of the economy, and the impact that that was having in a constituency with many people have, relatively low incomes and are therefore vulnerable to inflation, including inflation on food. Now, there, what was crucial, I think, is that the SNP were, in a sense, they're tying their message about more independence for Scotland and saying, well, if Scotland had more control over its oil revenues, we would be able to reduce the price of fuel. And that at least gave them a link between, as it were, the current discontent and their wider message, and meant they weren't just saying, well, isn't it terrible how bad the economy is? Here at least is a solution. Now, obviously, the Labour Party would argue it's a terribly inadequate solution, that it wouldn't work, but it did therefore give the SNP an angle for dealing with what is undoubtedly one of Labour's biggest problems now, its loss of reputation for economic competence.
The other big issue, of course, was this whole question of the deprivation of the East End of Glasgow and the appalling statistics when it comes to things like unemployment and obesity and so on, and life expectation.
But do you think some of the candidates perhaps made a mistake in talking up the deprivation and the poverty and, indeed, and talking down the East End.
And indeed, I think that was realised halfway through. And there was a sense in the Labour campaign of actually saying, look, don't let outsiders do down the East End. And almost creating an almost siege mentality to try and say, look, our opponents are trying to do down the East End, and so are the London media. And frankly, some of the things that the London media said were absurd and were failing to recognise the level of regeneration that genuinely has gone on in this area, even though the statistics are still appalling.
But of course, you have to realise one of the reasons why the Labour Party would want to do that is that one of the potential lines of attack that they might be vulnerable was, well, you've been running this place for 10 or 11 years or more, depending on what level of government you're talking about, yet things haven't got any better. So therefore, by trying to make it difficult for their opponents to talk about the social deprivation of the constituency, in a sense, they help to deflect that potential line of attack on their record.
Mm. Was there much talk on the campaign trail about Labour's record? Was that something that people were reflecting on, do you think, before casting their votes?
I think they were, a sense of disappointment amongst Labour voters that after 11 years of Labour government, they aren't as things haven't improved as much as they would have liked. And that essentially is, I think, the reason why, if as we expect, Labour has lost this by-election tonight. It isn't just 1 year of Gordon Brown's record. I think it is 11 years of Labour's record. That will prove decisive here, and that's why it's a problem really for the Labour Party and not just for the Prime Minister, this result.
OK, I see the returning officer on the platform.
Ladies
and
gentlemen, can I please have your attention, please? Can I invite the candidates and the candidates only to the right-hand side of the stage, please? Candidates and candidates only.
OK, now this is looking promising. I'm not saying that we're going to get the result in the next few seconds, but perhaps we are going to get it within the next few minutes. Remember, the candidates and their agents were called together to discuss with officials the results of the recount. Nobody, as far as we know, has called for a further check, a further recount, and now the returning officer for this by-election in Glasgow East has brought the candidates and only the candidates together at the side of the stage. I think we could be about to get a result. And if John Curtice, as we've been saying, this by-election results in a victory for the Scottish National Party, would that be the earthquake, the political earthquake, that Alex Salmond has been predicting throughout this campaign?
Well, I think undoubtedly it will be a tremor. But it's a tremor directed at Downing Street. And I think the crucial thing we haven't talked about tonight, it will not tell us very much at all about whether or not the people of Scotland will be willing to vote for independence in a referendum, if indeed a referendum were to be held. That wasn't central in this campaign. What the attraction of the SNP to voters in Scotland at the moment is bound up with the fact that it's a party that's willing to stand up for Scotland's interests, to use devolved government in order to promote those interests, including willing to have rows with Westminster in public if it deems it to be necessary. And it's that ability, I think, in the end to say, look, we are a party that's willing to advocate and defend Scotland's interests, that seems just to have managed to trump Margaret Curran's attempt to say, no, I will stand up for the interests of the East End.
You agree with that, Michael Crick?
Yes, I think it doesn't tell us much about independence, although the independence issue did come up during the campaign.
Wasn't raised much by the SNP, though, was
it? No, but Labour were keen to raise it and keen to portray John Mason as a hard-line nationalist and believer of independence. And there was something of a gaffe almost at one point when John Mason was asked if the independence referendum in a couple of years' time is lost, when he would want to hold another referendum. And he talked about comparing it to asking a woman to marry you and saying that you have to be persistent. And whereas, of course, the official SNP policy is that the Scots are supposed to wait a generation before the next referendum, which is roughly reckoned to be about 20 years.
Well, Alex Salmond is certainly promising to hold one on behalf of the devolved government in 2010, perhaps on St Andrew's Day in 2010, which would obviously be symbolic, and the SNP very keen to separate the issue of independence and the public's right to decide on a major constitutional change from elections. Of course, Labour and the other pro-union parties say that is settled at each and every election and that the SNP does not and will not get a mandate to take Scotland out of the United Kingdom after 300 years. We're just waiting, as you can see from the pictures there, for the small group on the left-hand side of your screen in the far corner, the group of nine candidates in this by-election, to step up those few steps onto the platform and for the returning officer, hopefully, to go with them and read from the piece of paper that I think he is carrying and give us all the results of this closely fought by-election campaign in Glasgow East. A city, of course, Glasgow, dominated by the Labour Party. They hold every Westminster seat, but do they retain Glasgow East? Let's find out now as the returning officer prepares to make his declaration in the Glasgow East by-election.
Okay. All right. I, Ian Drummond, Deputy Returning Officer for the United Kingdom Parliamentary Election in Glasgow East constituency, give notice that the total number of votes for each candidate is Chris Crichton, Independent, 67, Francis Curran, Scottish Socialist Party, 555, Margaret Curran, Scottish Labour Party, 10,912. Eileen Duke, Scottish Green Party, 232. Hamish Howitt, Freedom for Choice, 65. John F. Mason, Scottish National Party, SNP, 11,277. Tricia McLeish, Solidarity, Tommy Sheridan, 512. Davina Monica Rankin, Scottish Conservative and Unionist, 1,639. Ian Robertson, Scottish Liberal Democrats, 915. Ballot papers rejected, 45. Total votes, 26,219. And I declare that John Mason is duly elected to serve as the Member of the UK Parliament for the Glasgow East constituency.
Well, let's just look at that result confirmed, a victory for the Scottish National Party for the first time taking a seat from Labour in 20 years. John Mason, the victor, with 11,277 votes. Margaret Curran for Labour pushed into second place with 10,912 votes. The Conservatives pushing the Liberal Democrats out of that third place spot with 1,639 votes. The Liberal Democrats, Ian Robertson, fourth with 915, and the other five candidates sharing just over 1,400 votes between them. The majority then, very narrow indeed, a majority of 365 for the SNP over Labour in Glasgow East. The turnout there just over 42%. So the share, 43.1% for the SNP, just ahead of the Labour Party on 41.7%, the Conservatives on just over 6, Liberal Democrats on 3.5, the others sharing 5.5% of the vote. The change on last time, which of course was the UK-wide general election in 2005, the SNP up substantially, up 26%. They needed 22 to win over Labour. They got an increase in 26%, Labour down 19%. Let's hear from the new MP for Glasgow East, John Mason.
Who have welcomed the chance to have... who have welcomed the chance
to have their voice heard with such enthusiasm. To be a Glasgow MP is a tremendous honour and privilege, and I pledge to be a servant of the people here. People in this constituency have shown the world why the East End matters. You have shown that the East End must never be taken for granted again, as it has been in the past. Tonight is not only a victory for the SNP, it is a victory for Glasgow East. This is a new start for the East End. 3 weeks ago, the SNP predicted a political earthquake. This SNP victory is not just a political earthquake, it is off the Richter scale. It is an epic win, and the tremors are being felt all the way to Westminster. The SNP called on the people of Glasgow East to send a message, to send a message to Gordon Brown and Labour government that they are out of touch and that the SNP is on their side. That message is clear. It's time for change. Change to the policies that are taking our country and the UK in the wrong direction. It's time for action to help hard-pressed families with the soaring costs of food and fuel. Tonight's vote is a vote of confidence in Scotland, in the Scottish Government, and the progress the SNP is making. This is the first by-election which has put a Scottish government against a UK government, and the people of Glasgow East have made their voice clear. The SNP's victory last May brought a breath of fresh air to Scotland. The Scottish Government and the SNP will continue to work hard to earn the trust and support of the people of the East End and across Scotland. We will do all we can to make Scotland the successful country we all know it can be. And based upon this record of competence, success, and ambition, we will trust the people of Scotland to decide the best future for our nation. Tonight, we have removed the dead hand of Labour control. We can claim a new era of opportunity for Glasgow East and for Scotland. That is a message we will take with confidence to the people of Scotland in the weeks and months ahead. In October, Alex Salmond predicted the SNP would send 20 MPs to Westminster at the next general election. Tonight, the people of Glasgow East have delivered the first of these 20 MPs. Labour MPs across Scotland will be quaking in their boots. The East End has sent a powerful message, a message that is right now resonating in Downing Street. It is time for the East End to get the recognition it deserves. It's time for Scotland to stand up and to be heard. Thank you very much.
And applause there for Jon Mason. Let me get very quick reaction. Nicola Sturgeon.
It's an absolutely sensational result. This was Labour's third safest seat in Scotland. I think it's sixth safest seat in the UK. My warmest congratulations to Jon Mason. He was a fantastic candidate and he will be a first-class MP. I think what he said in his speech there was really significant. This is the first by-election in history that has pitted a Scottish government against a UK government. And the result tonight shows that this is a catastrophe for Labour in London and an enormous vote of confidence in Alex Salmond and the SNP government.
It's true, isn't it, Douglas Alexander? It is a catastrophe for Labour.
Well, clearly it's very disappointing, but let me first of all offer my personal congratulations to Jon Mason. It was a hard-fought campaign, as I said, and he's won a notable victory tonight, and I hope he serves the people of the East End of Glasgow well. I also predict that we will work very hard to unseat him and to return a Labour MP at the next general election in Glasgow East. We will, of course, reflect long and hard on the result this evening to try and understand the message that is being sent by the voters of Glasgow East, but I can assure you that long after the cameras have left, long after the press have departed, we will still be there in Glasgow East. working hard to regain the trust of the people of Glasgow and to ensure that we return Labour MPs.
If you just removed the word Glasgow from that and inserted Crewe and Nantwich, that was the same mantra that we heard months ago.
And I'm not going to pretend minutes after a result, I'm going to offer you instant solutions to some of the challenges that manifested themselves both in Crewe and Nantwich and in Glasgow East. We've had a long discussion this evening as to what some of the factors are that account for the result we've seen. I think we had a very strong organisation. I think we had an outstanding candidate in Margaret Curran. But nonetheless, we do have some answers to provide and some lessons to learn from tonight. But maybe a few minutes after the result, at almost 3 o'clock in the morning, is not the point at which to discern them. We'll take a little longer to do that.
Of course, and that's understandable. But you have to be able to say it's just more than very disappointing, isn't it? I mean, you know, you're right. We've had a very long discussion tonight about all manner of things. And why do you think your government is just so unpopular? The credit crunch hasn't really bitten yet. The oil prices are feeding their way through, but not yet. There has got to be something more profound. And you've had months to reflect on this because there have been months of bad results.
Sure, and I just have to reflect what I was told on doorsteps across the constituency, and that is that people do feel concerned in a way they haven't felt concerned in the last 11 years as we've driven down unemployment in Glasgow East or as we've provided worker opportunity. They do feel frustrated and they do feel concerned as to their economic futures. We've got to provide the solutions that give them the confidence that even in a global economic downturn, they've got a Labour government working on their behalf to provide solutions which they judge not simply to keep the economy moving forward, but that they judge to be fair as well. That's what we'll reflect on. But as I say, it's not a night for instant solutions. It's a night for humility. If you want me to say it's a bad result, I'll say it's a bad result. Of course we need to learn the lessons from tonight. I give you my word that that's exactly what we will do. We will continue to reflect on these results in the days and weeks ahead, because actually we do hold ourselves to a high standard. We do want to serve not simply one part of the country, but every part of the country. It hurts us to lose a seat like Glasgow East, and we're determined to win it back.
When you see the approval ratings for Gordon Brown continually flatlining, what would it take to convince you that Gordon Brown is part of the problem?
We have a phrase about collective responsibility in government, and I think the honest answer to your question is to say we all share the responsibility for tonight's result, and we have to shoulder that responsibility. I don't think it's a night to say it's about one individual. Even your independent commentators, whether it be Professor Curtice or whether it be Michael Crick, themselves conceded that actually there are deeper issues at work here in terms of how, as a Labour Party, we ask and secure support over a fourth term, because clearly, after three terms in government, people do want to see what are your answers to the challenges that we're facing.
Of course there's collective cabinet responsibility, but Gordon Brown is the Prime Minister. He is the figurehead of the government. His approval ratings are at rock bottom. What would it take to convince you that he is part of the problem?
Well, I accept that we face a challenge, but I don't think you can honestly assess tonight's result as being a judgment on a single individual. Rather, it's a judgment on the concerns that people are feeling and the desire to send a message. I don't think there was a great sea change in favour of independence, incidentally, in Glasgow East. I do think with the collapse of the Liberal Democrat vote, with the hard work of SNP activists, they convinced enough people this evening that they were an effective means to protest and to send a message to the Labour government. And in that sense, we will look at those lessons, we will continue to talk, we will continue to engage, we will continue to work with voters, not just in Glasgow East, but across the country, to make sure that the real conversation that happens in the days ahead is not limited to a conversation within the Labour Party, but actually continues to be a conversation with the voters.
What is your message to Labour MPs who are now fearful about their seats and worried that actually Gordon Brown is going to cost them the next election, and maybe thinking, right, what we need to do now is start organising and moving against the Prime Minister?
The first thing I'd probably do is remind them what the back of our party card says, which says by the strength of our common endeavour we can achieve more than we can alone. And secondly, I'd ask them to reflect on the time when I joined the Labour Party, which was in 1982, not in the heady heights of New Labour success, but at a time of repeated and bitter defeats for the Labour Party. We learned a very serious lesson at that point, which is that divided parties lose. And actually, whatever the challenges we face, we're better equipped to meet those challenges if we work together, we campaign together, and ultimately then I believe we can win together.
So give Gordon Brown more time to get it right.
Well, all of us need to work hard. It's not simply a matter for the Prime Minister or for the Cabinet. This is not actually about the fate of the government as much as the direction of the country. And in that sense, we need to continue to work hard to communicate our message and to secure the support whenever the general election comes.
Murdo Fraser, 1,639 votes, I think. Is that the high watermark of Cameronism?
Well, first of all, can I offer my congratulations to John Mason on his election as a Member of Parliament? You know, John's a decent guy. He fought hard to win this seat. Well done to him. And I'm sure he'll serve the people of Glasgow East with distinction as a Member of Parliament. It's a disaster, this result, for Gordon Brown and for his government. Gordon Brown, a Scottish Prime Minister, defending a seat, the third safest Labour seat in his heartland, losing it with a huge swing. We saw in Crewe and Nantwich that where the Conservatives are challenging, we can win with a huge swing of Labour. Tonight, when the SNP were challenging, they did the same. As far as we're concerned, look, I said at the start of this programme a long, long time ago, if you can remember back that far, that you know, if you weren't the defending party or the challenger, your vote was always going to face a squeeze. Look what happened to the Liberal Democrats. Our vote was squeezed by less than 1%, by a fraction of 1%, and we leapt from fourth place to third place. At the last elections, general election result, the Liberal Democrats nearly had twice the vote we did. Tonight, they've got roughly half the vote that we've got. We've shown that the Conservatives are making progress in all parts of the United Kingdom, even at a time when we were not in the running for this particular seat. 402nd out of 421 seats on our target list. We've still held our share of the vote. We've leapt to third place. We are contenders in Scottish politics. We are the third force, and Scottish politics is now looking increasingly like a three-horse race, and that's good news in seats where we are challenging Labour and indeed the Lib Dems.
Jo Swinson, it's miserable, isn't it?
Well, there's been a lot of Liberal Democrat fabulous by-election victories, some of which we've discussed tonight, like Brent East and Dunfermline. But there's also been some perhaps less memorable by-election results for the Lib Dems. For example, when we came sixth behind the Hamilton Accies football club in the 1999 Hamilton South by-election, or in 2000 in Falkirk when we came fifth with 3.2% of the vote. The important thing to remember is that after those by-election results, we went on to beat the Conservatives in Scotland at the 2001 general election. And I certainly predict that we will gain votes again in Glasgow East at the next election, and perhaps more importantly, look to make progress across other areas of Glasgow.
In answer to my question, the answer is yes. It is a miserable night for you tonight.
Well, we had an excellent candidate, and I think
that candidates. 2:38 in the morning.
I don't think that our result in any way reflects on the strength of our candidate. I think we were squeezed completely by the SNP.
It's a miserable result.
I certainly would have much rather that we got more votes, but that's the way. That's how things happen in politics and by-elections sometimes.
Miserable result?
I'm certainly not happy about it. I don't know if you want to judge me as miserable. I'll leave that up to you to judge. But I do think that we need to recognise that it is a by-election, and congratulations to John Mason. It's a privilege to be a Member of Parliament, and I'm sure he will recognise that. I would say, though, I mean, there's been SNP by-election victories in the past, and they don't necessarily have a good history of holding on to them at the next general election. I'm sure it will be hard fought when it comes to 2010. I think what it also does show is...
Nicola Sturgeon, are you enjoying everyone predicting his demise before he's even yet got to Westminster?
I know the caveats that have to be applied to this, but the kind of swing John has achieved in Glasgow East tonight would wipe out almost every single Labour MP in Scotland if replicated at a general election, including, I'm sorry to say, Douglas Alexander. But, you know, I think we're in a completely different place in Scotland now. And, you know, long may Douglas Alexander continue to stick his head in the sand the way he's done over the last few minutes and try to pretend that it'll all be business as usual come the general election. We're in a very different place. I spoke to people on the streets and on the doorsteps of Glasgow East who didn't just say they wanted to send a temporary message. They were saying that they would never vote Labour again. That's how fundamental and that's how deeply out of touch people think that Labour are. We're also in a different place because, as has already been said tonight, the SNP are in government in Scotland. We are a popular government, although we'll never be complacent. We'll continue to work hard to win people's support. And our credibility and our support is growing because of that. So I would, sitting here right now at whatever time it is on the early hours of Friday morning, I would not bet against John Mason at all from holding that seat with an increased majority when it comes to general election.
Well, I tell you what, let's have a listen to Margaret Curran, who came close but has actually the history books will note suffered a catastrophic swing. The SNP needed a 21.83% swing to win the seat. They have exceeded that. Let's listen to what Margaret Curran had to say just a few minutes ago, conceding defeat.
Thanks to the returning officer, to the staff at Tollcross Leisure Centre, to the police and to the many workers who helped us throughout our campaign, and I thank them most sincerely. I regret that I did not win this for Labour tonight. And I do believe the Labour Party has to listen and has to hear the message from the people of Glasgow East. But let me say to you, as a continuing elected representative of the East End of Glasgow, that my commitment to them is undiminished. I said at the beginning of this campaign that I'm in politics because I am driven to tackle poverty, to tackle inequality, and to liberate the people of Scotland and Great Britain from those great injustices. And my commitment to that remains as strong as ever, and I will continue in that drive. Can I also make it clear, whilst I regret losing this election, and I understand that loss, I do not regret standing in this election, because to me, fundamentally, Labour is a cause and not a career, and it is a cause I will continue to pursue. The cause of Labour... The cause of Labour over this past century has been to tackle inequality and injustice. And we have faced hurdles and challenges before. We will face this one because inequality is the greatest cause of humankind and is at the heart of Labour. And I remain a true champion of that cause. Thank you.
Margaret Curran for Labour conceding defeat in the Glasgow East by-election. She said that she regretted losing, of course, but that she didn't regret standing in that election. It has, if you've just joined us, been won by the Scottish National Party. And we can take a look more closely at what's actually happened in Glasgow East. There's the swing. It's a big swing from Labour to the SNP of 22.54%. And Professor John Curtice, we heard John Mason, the victor, saying that Labour MPs would be quaking in their boots all over the country. Is that true?
Well, they're certainly going to be quaking their boots in Scotland. I mean, if we play what is always a little bit of fantasy politics this time of the night, as saying what would happen if the whole of Scotland were to swing in the way that Glasgow East did tonight, and the answer is there would be one Labour MP left in Coatbridge, and there would be 50 SNP MPs. That gives you some idea of the scale of the victory. Now, that said, I mean, if the Labour Party kind of wanted a bit of good news about this, and since it is true that the swing against Labour is not as big as it was in Glasgow Governed Twice, it's also not as big in some of those big by-election losses that Tony Blair suffered in the last Parliament in places like Brent South and in Leicester South. But I think the thing Labour Party has to appreciate is, for example, if you take those last examples, there was something special happening. Those were constituencies with substantial Muslim populations upset about Iraq war. Now, what we've seen tonight is a 19-point drop in the Labour vote in a constituency where, in truth, there was nothing particularly going for the SNP locally. Equally, in Crewen Nantwich a few weeks ago, the Labour vote fell by 18 points in a constituency where there wasn't anything particularly going for the Conservatives locally. So what, in other words, we're now seeing are serious, consistent Labour losses of votes of nearly 20% or so in constituencies where, as it were, the Labour Party doesn't suffer any particular disadvantage. Now, no one by-election tells you something about the fate of the government, but that collectivity of evidence begins to give you an idea of how big Labour's problems are.
Well, it is the SNP's night, and we can talk now with the winning candidate, John Mason, who's now the MP for Glasgow East, and indeed with his boss, the First Minister of Scotland and SNP leader, Alex Salmond. Well, congratulations to you, John Mason, first of all. You must have had a few nail-biting moments during that count.
Well, it's a tremendous privilege to be serving the people of the East End. And I was confident in the people of the East End that they would make the right choice. So I've not been too nervous about it.
When did you know you'd done it?
Well, I think it became increasingly apparent as the count went on. But obviously there was a recount, so we had to wait for that.
Well, listen, I've offered my congratulations. How about you, Alex Salmond? Would you like to say a few words to your new MP?
I certainly would. I mean, John has been an outstanding candidate. This has been one of the sharpest, the quickest by-elections in political history, and we were immensely fortunate to have somebody like John, who's held in such high regard in the East End. That gave us an advantage which it was immeasurable in terms of establishing the campaign's credibility. So congratulations to John, and he, like me, of course, wants to congratulate the entire campaign team, who are just immense in the Scottish National Party.
John Mason?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, it was a team effort, and Alec is clearly the captain of the team, but there are many, many important players in the SNP team. And I'm extremely grateful to all of them.
Well, maybe you would want at this stage, Jon Mason, to speak directly to Alex Salmond and thank him for turning up, what was it, nearly a dozen times to support you?
That's right, and that confidence of Alec was tremendous. And
well,
seeing how he related... Sorry?
You can thank him directly. He's listening.
Well, I can thank him officially. OK, thank you, Alec, very much for coming. But what the point I was going to make was the people of the East End responded so positively to having Alec Salmond out there. And that shows the success of the SNP government over the last year.
So was this your victory, Alec Salmond, or John Mason's victory?
No, John's the candidate, and John established that platform of credibility. But it's not John's victory or my victory. I think it's a victory for the SNP campaign team, for the cause of the SNP, and of course for the people of Glasgow East. And I think the benefits that will flow from this victory will flow primarily to the people of Glasgow East, but will be have ramifications across the country. John, you are right, Glenn. I've paid 12 visits. I'm just about to pay my 13th visit if John can keep the party going in Glasgow East for me. So the 13th visit might be considered unlucky for some.
You're about to get in a fast car.
Well, I don't know. Listen, the First Minister of Scotland can't break any speed limits, but I'll get there as quick as I can, John, if you save some of the lemonade for me.
I certainly will do that. Yes, you'll be very welcome. The people of East End want to see you in East End.
Thanks, John. I'm sporting an East End suntan, incidentally.
You've pretty much holidayed in the East End over the last couple of weeks. You say, though, it's John Mason's result, yet you have, throughout this campaign, Alex Salmond, said that it was a contest between the Scottish government and the UK government, between Alex Salmond and Gordon Brown.
Well, certainly I said that there had to be a judgment taken by the people, and just as they were judging on the failures of the London government, I said in response to a question, and I acknowledge it, that they would pass judgment on the success of the Scottish government, the SNP government in Holyrood. And I know a number of Scottish journalists described that as bold or even foolhardy, and even one or two commentators suggested it wasn't the wisest thing to do. I think it's an inevitable thing to do because this is a unique by-election. This is a by-election fought not just between two candidates, not just between two political parties, but uniquely between two governments. That has never happened before, as far as I know, in political history, and I think that gives it an additional importance. But the ramifications for this by-election, you just heard John Curtice say there'll only be one Labour MP left in Scotland. It'll be Tom Clarke, so I'm sure he's a relieved man tonight. But everybody else in the Labour ranks, including Gordon Brown, would be getting their jotters in the sort of swing that John Mason has achieved this evening.
But what do you think the direct ramifications of this result will be? Douglas Alexander saying too early to say what will change, but what do you think will change?
Well, that's what Mao Zedong said about the French Revolution. I think Douglas is playing for time. I think, and I've never said throughout this campaign, I don't think we'll see an immediate exit of Gordon Brown from Downing Street. I think he's much more likely to change policy rather than change himself. And the policy that needs to be changed, of course, is on the economy. We need a plan for recovery. We need a plan to stave off recession. And we need action taken, as John Mason said in his victory speech, very rightly, to ease the pressure on household budgets across Glasgow East and across Scotland. That's the action that must come from this message being delivered from the voters, the people of Scotland, right down to Downing Street.
I think it's chucking out time at the count, John Mason, so perhaps we should think about letting you go to your victory celebration. But
I think it was chucking out time in Glasgow East, Glenn.
Your victory celebration will obviously be followed by your visit to Westminster as one of seven SNP MPs. What kind of contribution do you think you can actually make in a big parliament with more than 600 members?
Yes, well, my experience is speaking out for the people of the East End and Glasgow City Council, which has been very Labour-dominated. So there are certain parallels with going to Westminster, and I think my reputation shows that I'm not afraid to speak out against the establishment.
OK, well, we'll listen for your maiden speech, Jon Mason, and First Minister Alex Salmond, the SNP leader in Edinburgh. Thank you both very much indeed. And John Curtice, there we have the new MP for Glasgow East, who says that he's removed the dead hand of Labour control in the East End of Glasgow. Has he got a point?
Well, I mean, certainly if you were critical of Labour's record in the East End of Glasgow, obviously you would take that comment. I think the crucial thing to say is that, as it were, you know, what this by-election has now very firmly indicated is that north of the border, the next Westminster election is going to be a battle between the SNP and the Labour Party, and that we cannot, at least at this juncture, discount the possibility that the SNP might make significant gains to the Labour Party. And I think we should also say it also very firmly indicates that the Cameron revival of the Conservative Party has not yet penetrated north of the border.
Despite what Murdo said,
the Conservative share of the vote actually fell, and we cannot say why this is because of peculiar to its constituency, because if you look at the opinion polls in Scotland, they still fail to register any significant Conservative recovery.
OK, well, let's hear from our politicians again in the company of Jon Sopel. John.
Thank you very much indeed. And this, let's just kind of ask a final question before we come off air, which is, what has changed in politics tonight? Nicola Sturgeon.
Oh, I mean, there's an enormous shockwave gone all the way from the East End of Glasgow to Downing Street. I think all sorts of things will change. The East End's on the map, Scotland's on the map. I am absolutely convinced that there will be now change in policy terms from Labour. Hopefully that will be changed to relieve the burden that people are feeling on fuel costs, for example. But it also, as I've said before, it sends an enormous vote of confidence to the Scottish Government and will ensure that we can continue with the good work we're doing that's winning so much support right across the country.
Douglas Alexander, what's changed?
Well, clearly we've got a new Member of Parliament for Glasgow East. I think it has deepened the sense within the Labour Party, certainly within my mind, that now is not the time for instant solutions but for a serious and searching examination of the messages that were being sent. To be respectful of the view that has been taken over the course of the last 24 hours in Glasgow East, and to be resolute in a determination to learn the right lessons, to work together to rise to that challenge, and to try and take back Glasgow East at the coming general election.
Makes the party conference difficult and challenging?
Well, listen, the party conference will be the opportunity after the National Policy Forum to set out the raft of policies that we will take forward both in the remainder of this Parliament and look forward to setting out in the general election. It was always going to be an important conference. I don't think the result tonight changes the significance of the conference, because the conference was always going to be an important conference.
But doesn't it underline that you have lost the trust of the people?
Well, it certainly reflects the fact that we've got a great deal of work to do to win that fourth term. We knew that before Glasgow East. If there was anybody within the party in any doubt that we needed to respond effectively to these challenges, then I think those doubts will have dissipated this evening.
Murdo Fraser, the change, what is it?
What's changed in Scottish politics tonight is that the Conservatives are a serious force in Scottish politics with momentum. And John Curtice simply got it wrong. All the smaller parties faced a squeeze on their vote. The only party which didn't see their vote squeezed were the Conservatives. We went from fourth to third place. And you know, Jon Mason in his victory speech tonight said it was time for a change. He's right, it is time for a change, but in Scotland the change has to be to David Cameron,
the only person
who can replace Gordon Brown.
I think what has changed is that people are asking themselves the question, what and whom do Labour stand for? If they don't stand for a constituency like Glasgow East for people on low incomes, then where exactly are they going?
All right, well, it has been an amazing night for the SNP, for Alex Salmond and Jon Mason. More than a 20% swing. It's been a bitter blow for Labour, for Gordon Brown and their candidate, Margaret Curran. That's all from us. If you want to see the programme again, it's on the iPlayer. More news is always on the BBC Scotland's website. And I'm not going to stop being heckled by these people. And Good Morning Scotland is on Radio Scotland this morning at 6 o'clock. Good night, or should that be good morning? There's gonna be a change. Better find your way.